Hey, what's good? What's good? What's good? Welcome to Reflections of a DJ, the Role Podcast, presented by DJ City and Beat Source. I'm one of your hosts, DJ Crooked. We got DJ Never here.
Yo, yo, what up?
We got DJ D Miles.
What up? What up?
We got Jamie the Great.
Yeah.
This is the LA edition of Road Podcast. We're here in Beat Source offices in West Hollywood. We got a special guest. We've been wanting this very special individual to come on the show for a minute. Mm-hmm. We were actually shocked that he's listened to, I guess, a few of our episodes or maybe more.
A few? A shit ton. Listen to most of them.
Yeah. I mean, we shocked that he's cool with Jamie.
Yeah. We're best friends.
Yeah, you know, we have basically Roc-A-Fella royalty in the building.
Mm-hmm.
He's one of the best A&Rs in hip-hop.
Mm-hmm.
One of the best ears for talent and music in hip-hop.
Mm-hmm.
He's been a part of some of the most classic albums in hip-hop history.
Yep.
His management company, Hip Hop Since 1978, has managed legends like Just Blaze, Kanye West, Jeezy, T.I., Lil Wayne, Nicki Minaj, Drake, Griselda. He's also responsible for writing hooks for some of the most classic Jay-Z songs like Big Pimpin' and Song Cry. You know, we have the amazing Hip Hop in the building. Hip Hop, what's good, sir?
Yo, yo, yo. What's up? What's up?
Pleasure.
What's good?
Man.
Yep.
So, wait. I want to know a couple of things. Why do you listen to our podcast?
How'd you come across
How'd you stumble onto this DJ podcast, this obscure DJ podcast? And why are you and Jamie so tight? Why y'all cool?
My guy. Not me? I'm answering the last one first.
Yeah.
Tacos. Millie's. You know,
Tacos, Millie's. You know the vibes.
Yeah, Silver Lake, that area.
Gang.
But how did I come across it? I listen to a lot of music podcasts, so I think it might have popped up during that time. But the first one I remember was during the Rock the Con 8-track thing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so I think that one kind of like had me like, dang, what is this? Like,
what's going on?
Yeah.
And you saw something buzzing on Twitter or something? Or what?
Nah, I think that I think I seen the names, like the people who I was like, you know, yes, and then I seen what it was, like the DJ podcast. I was like, let me check it out. And I don't go out a lot or in that scene, so it kind of was like an insight to stuff that I'm around but don't really know about.
Right.
So, you know what I mean? So a lot of things y'all talk about, you know, I just never knew, you know what I mean? And there's certain things I'm sure that, yeah, like, I know exactly what y'all talking about, you know what I mean, from a music standpoint.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it's like, you know, I think a lot of this, some of us is the same age, some of us same places, you know what I mean?
I think you and I are a year apart.
Yeah. Mm-hmm, yeah, so I think, you know, just that aspect of it and just, like, the different point of views, the different ages and stuff, I think it just covers a good, you know, gave me a real good insight, especially, like, during... before the pandemic, like during that time when it was like records of the years and
right.
What's happening in the club?
Because you're getting to hear like what the DJs are talking about, like candidly,
exactly,
and like you're right, just honestly speaking,
yeah, and seeing when it changed too. I think it was maybe one of your episodes when
they focus on Never?
Yeah, when they focus on Never.
It might have been Never's birthday.
Yeah, Never.
Yeah.
Dude, that was four years ago.
Yeah, oh, wow. So I remember that one being early because I remember being like, dang, they was DJing around the time when I was, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, like the late 90s. Same records and stuff. And, you know, so it's like just hearing like a dual perspective. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. For like the time that I lived through. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's like we were around the same eras, but in two different worlds a little bit, right?
Yeah. You guys were playing the records.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And he was making the records.
Yeah, exactly. That's the thing is that you were in the studio making these records.
Yeah.
And then you're hearing about us playing them and how the crowds and how the clubs were reacting at the time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Like I never really went to the clubs like that.
Really?
Yeah, the first time I went to the club was with Jay.
Of course.
This little place called the Tunnel.
Yeah. 94, 95.
But you was in...
I was in high school.
And you was in high school.
And it was the Country Club on 86th Street.
I remember that spot.
Yeah. Maria Davis.
Mm-hmm.
It was it was like her night. Everybody was performing. Original Flav was performing. Jay was performing. Oh, Cam. Wow. Children of the Corn was performing. The chick we had, Roughness, she was performing. So it was like Dame had his whole... basically everybody he was representing kind of like had a slot. And because it was kind of like an unsigned night almost, you know what I mean? To where almost like showcase every time.
But there was a lot of showcases at that time, right?
Yeah, a lot of showcases.
For artists.
Yep.
Because at the time, Reasonable Doubts wasn't even out yet, right?
Like no. He used to rap over like Raekwon beats. Like,
oh, shit.
Mainly. He had In My Lifetime. Both of those. He had Coming of Age. They used to perform that. Him and Bleak would perform that as a new record.
Was it the same beat for Coming of Age?
Mm-hmm. And he would do Can't Knock the Hustle over Criminology.
Oh, really?
Yeah. What the fuck? Like real aggressive, making short term codes when the weather folds. You know what I mean? He was doing that. You know, a couple records. He did the 22 twos. Mm-hmm. That was in the show.
I love that record.
Mm-hmm. So he had a full show with the In My Lifetime records. I'm trying to think how he ended it. Later on, he ended up having like Ain't No, and that was like the main record at the time. He had a couple features, like the Shy record. Yeah, performed that. Oh, you know, a couple records.
The Hose on. Brown.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Taste. What is it?
Yeah. Do for Love.
Do for Love. Remix. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
See,
yeah.
I always thought like you was running Baseline Studios, right, with Young Guru, kind of.
Yeah. I kind of like hired him. Yeah. So I was already there. Like I got the I convinced Juan to build Baseline Studio. Mm. Like Juan wanted to start a label, and I was like, why don't you build a studio? Him and Malik Sealy, rest in peace.
Oh, oh yeah. Shit. I didn't know that.
Yeah, Malik Sealy, damn.
Yeah.
So the Timberwolves dude.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah.
So I would
St. John's.
Yeah, St. John's. That was my team.
Yeah.
So I would have thought, like, I thought the way it worked was y'all would record at the studio, and then y'all would just go to the club right afterwards.
Right. They will, but the thing was that other artists would come, so I would have to stay.
Ah.
You know, like Beans would come late. After Jay would leave. So Jay was quick. You know, he would come in like at 6 o'clock and be gone by like 10 o'clock.
10.
Yeah. Like, you know, he's not like a late night studio person unless he's just hanging out.
So then typically, how long were you at the studio for? Shit.
All 24.
He literally. He showered and Larry slept. Like,
sometimes we'd get a room and just to take showers, me, Justin, Guru, and we'd just like come back, give each other the keys, and we'd go take showers and stuff. I ended up moving closer to the studio, so, you know, that was the thing. But we'd kind of just alternate taking naps and shit like that because like Dipset came early. They came like 11 o'clock
in the morning?
Yeah, in the morning, before noon.
Yeah.
Cam was coming to the studio. And waking people up. So we'll start working with them first. Then by the time they leave in like 6 o'clock, Jay's coming. And then Jay probably leave at like 12 and then Beans is coming. And then Beans is gonna be there all night. And then when Dipset come, like Beans, it's like they gotta like step over state property. Like like sleep, you know what I mean? Like Cam would do verses while niggas are sleeping on the couch from yesterday. You know what I mean? So it'd be like that.
That's a crazy scene.
You know.
So you were like the operator for like a hip hop sweatshop. You just
basically.
And then you had to like remember what songs they needed to record. Were you organizing all of that pretty much?
Yeah. Like that's where like Lenny S and G come in.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like they wasn't really there, but they would just come in and like extract stuff. You know what I'm saying? Like, yo, here's these new songs. They come, you know, download all the information from me and they'll take it back to the office as far as credits and admin stuff. And even when the songs is finished and I mixed it, most of the time they'll take it to the mastering and stuff like that sometimes. Like I have to go master, but they would take the actual tapes. You know what I mean? Like I would just stay there.
So this was like 6 days a week? 7 days a week? Just
like I would just go home, you know, just randomly, more or less, like, you know, if I gotta do something or, you know, just I'll be back in a few hours type of thing.
It's still but if the artist hits you like, yo, I wanna record, it was just back to the studio.
Yeah, somebody is always there. So it's never they can't record if I'm not there.
So how long was that going on, that kind of way of living?
Probably like a good 5 years, 4 or 5 years.
5 years, 6 years, full shit.
So it's like, what, 98 to like 04?
03.
03.
Yeah, it, for me, it kind of ended in 03, but not really, because the Black Album, the Freeway was like 03. Yeah, so, yeah, the last thing was like Black Album and Freeway was the last thing I did in that thing. It continued for a little bit after me, but not in that way. Because then I ended up, me and Just, we ended up buying Baseline, and that was like, you know, another, that's like later on. That's like Saigon and stuff like that.
And you discovered Just Blaze?
Yeah, actually G found Just Blaze, or yeah, G, or one of the artists we had. They just came to us and was like, yo, we found this new producer. He can make beats like anybody, and he only charged this much. I think it was like 10 grand or 5 grand, something like that. And that's how they kind of introduced him to us. And he had beats that sounded like, he had soulful beats, he had like Swiss type beats, he had.
What was the first beat that caught your ear from Just Blaze?
It was a joint called Who the Fuck Want What? With Beans and Bleak. It was like their first record, mm-hmm. was the first one, but it was a big pun record he did that was on a pun album. And so I was hearing the stuff he did, and I just heard like his, I could hear his talent. Mm-hmm. You know, that's what I kind of was focusing on. More like, okay, this guy could do a lot of stuff, because I had a lot of artists.
Yeah.
And I needed like that type of versatility. And the other producers kind of had their own thing already, whether Kanye, Bink, and like No ID. Like, I went to them for what they was already doing. At least Bink, for sure. But Kanye, he was able to change up, and like, he was sampling more because I wanted samples more than it was like, oh, I'm just a, you know, he wasn't technically a boom bap producer. Like, he was, you know, he was trying to be big. He was
producing based off of your need.
Yeah, he was trying to be big. He had records. He was like more into JD, more into like bigger records, like trying to like maybe not sample. But that's why I think his sample stuff sounds so different than everybody else. It's like the drums and everything is like, he's not trying to do what everybody else is doing, like hide everything. It's like, it's almost like a separate, like the drums could live on their own, like sometimes when the way he programmed it and stuff. So it was a, that was always his thing, but he wasn't like trying to be that, but that was kind of like what we was going for at that time, mm-hmm. because I just felt musically hip hop, we just had like too much keyboards and stuff like that. And it kind of was like, you know, I couldn't feel it like I felt like Supreme Clientele or something like that.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
That was kind of like, maybe you could say like the main influence for me, you know what I mean, taste wise was Cuban Links and you know, and Ghost, like RZA.
That early RZA sound.
Yeah, the early RZA sound.
Which is kind of like that raw, chopped up samples, like a little bit.
Right, yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's not really premiere-ish, but it's like gritty, and you're hearing exactly where the sample came from.
Exactly, yeah, right? 100%, yeah.
And mm-hmm. it kind of, it's like, it's still relevant to this day, because you hear like Griselda kind of rhyming over a very similar style.
Yep.
Except with like, you know, more subtle drums.
Yep.
And
yeah,
it's
for
like,
sure.
You know, it's like this sample loop.
Yeah, it's like album cuts and interludes.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? Stuff that people would be like, nah, we can't put that out. Because I remember that being the case with What We Do. Even though what we do is wrong, we still hustle till the sun come up. Crack a 40 when the sun go down. It's a cold winter. Y'all niggas better bundle up.
What We Do.
Yeah, when I first did that record, we did it out here, actually, and I was excited. I was like, dang, this record is crazy. And they was like, nah, we can't put it out. I was like, why not? They were like,
wait, who said no?
Dame.
Why?
He said it don't have a hook.
Mm.
So he was like, yo, y'all got to put a hook on it. You know, we can't put out a single without no hook. I was like, all right, cool. So we went back, tried to do a hook for like days. We just kept trying and trying. And I'm like, I can't put none of these hooks on there. We're going to have to just leave it how it is. And they was like, well, if you leave it like it is, we'll just white label it.
Wow.
So it was really just a white label.
Did he was saying that even with Jay's verse on it?
Yeah, even with Jay's verse, the way it was. Yeah.
God damn, yeah. Bro.
Because it wasn't, I think that energy, that's what I was kind of just going off of. Like, yeah. It wasn't no, I didn't know, you know, what to do. I never really, you know, was thinking about structure or anything.
It was yeah, because like, it was like that Reservoir Dogs energy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Where you like Reservoir Dogs, you can't really have a hook. It just went to the beat.
Right to the beat.
And then what's his name? Talking shit. The dude who imitated Scarface.
Pain in the ass.
Pain in the ass.
Pain in the ass. Just talking shit on that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's so with that kind of record, how did you convince them to put it out? Because that was a single.
It wasn't the single.
It wasn't?
No. The single was the record with Alan Anthony from Chris John. All Right was the single.
Mm-hmm.
And then that record kind of was a white label that ended up just bubbling up.
Ooh.
To the point where you couldn't really stop it. And then they was like, hey, let's shoot a video for it.
Got it.
I was going to ask you about that. I'm like, damn, it got to the point where you had to shoot a video. That's what it was the conception that it was a single.
Yeah, yep. Mm-hmm. By the time it was over,
yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. And what did Dame? How did Dame feel about that after?
I don't know. He never really thought about it. Talked about it again because I never really like.
I told you so.
Yeah, like I kind of stayed in the zone of the studio, so it was like, I know me and what you call it didn't talk. Freeway.
Really?
Yep. We didn't really speak after that.
Why?
Because the record that they wanted, I didn't like the record. So he came with the record and he was like, yo, I got the single. Because they was like, yo, we need the hook. We need all these things. Because Freeway had, you know, he did have like a big buzz. You know what I'm saying? Coming off Rock the Mic and all the records he had. So they was really trying to like nail it. You know what I mean? And I'm like, nah, this is it. And I had other records I thought was it as well. Like the Flip Side and a couple other records. But they, you know, he did that record and I wasn't there. And then he played it for me. He's like, yo, this is going to be the single. And I was like, he's like, what you think? I was like, I don't think it should be on the album.
Wow.
And I think he kind of felt bad or, you know what I mean, and stuff. And then the album was over at that point, you know, and I was kind of gone, one foot in, one foot out.
You just submitted it, right?
Yeah, like once I kind of finish an album, I don't even listen to it no more. It's like I'm already on the next one.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So by the time we did that, I think I was Black Album. I was already starting the Black Album or something like that. And so I was like, okay, cool. If that's what y'all want to do, that's what y'all want to do. But I wasn't with it. And then eventually the other records started to work and stuff like that. And then that was just that.
So that never released. It never got anything. It's still like kind of.
Which one?
The Flip Side record that he wanted to.
Yeah, it came out. It ended up being the second single.
Oh, which one was that?
Yeah, Flipside, man.
Oh, we're talking about Flipside?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you wasn't feeling Flipside.
I was feeling Flipside. I wasn't feeling the Alan Anthony record. That came out. The video came out and everything for that record.
Yeah.
Okay. The All Right, the one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But then the next two ones was What We Do and Flipside.
Yeah.
So I thought those could have been the single when they picked the one that was the first one, but it kind of just got glossed over, basically.
But y'all was never cool after that?
I mean, I just stopped seeing him because I stopped working there. And we never, you know what I mean? So it was like he was kind of like at the office because he was finished recording. So it was like when you finish recording, you kind of shift to the office and you starting to, you know, promote. Do your credits, do your artwork, thank yous, and, you know, shit like that.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? So he was like into that mode. And I was definitely doing the Black Album because that was the last thing I did.
It's funny, like when we do, like when you do reach out and you DM, you know, like we DM on Instagram sometimes.
Yeah.
It seems like you're so fascinated, like with, like, you know, when Goldfinger was killing the clubs.
Right.
With that whole era.
Mm hmm.
And it was like, because I guess you were working so much, you never got to go out during that time.
Yeah, he lived in the studio.
Yeah, like everything for me is mixtapes. Like everything was mixtapes. Like, because I could just take them and just do what I got to do. So I just always was like buying all of them from like the Uptown ones to like Fat Beats and what was that other place around the corner from Fat Beats? It was like a Nubian type place.
Oh yeah, that sold the incense and
The incense and all that. Yeah.
It was like a Rastafarian
style. Yeah. I want to say like House of Shabazz or something like that.
House of Nubian.
House of Nubian. Yeah, I used to go in there because they'll have like the gold finger, like all the other type of mixtapes and stuff like that. Yeah. Stuff, you know, kind of getting into even like the Roc-A-Fella mixtape, stuff like, you know, like those type of things. Like I still got all of them now, more or less digitized and stuff. But yeah, so I was more into that. The club thing, I kind of didn't ever really had the time. I go once in a while, like if they go in and I'm, you know, maybe nobody show up.
Yeah.
Because Beans wasn't every night because he lived in Philly. So it's like, that's why he would come at 12 because he would drive up from Philly and maybe stay in town for like 2-3 days and then he's out for a couple of days. So, you know, a lot of times I might go out every now and then, but for the most part, if I did, it was Tunnel of Speed. You know what I mean? Just like, because I wanted to feel what we was doing, more or less.
How was that feeling when you just saw, when you heard the record and you started just going off in the club and shit?
Yeah, it was, I think one of the first times I really felt that was where something like I did and thought it was going to work and it worked was the, it was some Bleak records first, honestly. The early Bleak records, like the like those records, because I always, like everything was the Tunnel for me. It was like, okay, it got to work in the Tunnel. It wasn't radio, it wasn't like nothing else, because we wasn't doing venues, we wasn't doing touring. So it was like the Tunnel. That was the, I guess you could say, the epitome for what the record could do if it could really make the Tunnel go crazy. That's what I was kind of going for. A Tunnel banger.
Yeah,
that's what they used to call them, right? a tunnel banger. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, so it was like, that was like my goal musically. So the Do It Again record.
12 a.m. on my way to the club. 1 a.m. DJ made it a rub. 2 a.m. now I'm getting with her. 3 a.m. now I'm splitting with her.
Was the one.
To Do It Again is big.
Do It Again, yeah.
I remember they filmed it at the Tunnel, right?
Filmed it at the Tunnel. And I remember Rockwilder giving me the beat with the intro. And I was like, oh, this is going to be crazy in the Tunnel and stuff. And then people didn't want it. Like Beans didn't want it. Bleak didn't want it. And then Jay ended up taking it. But it was sat there for a long time.
Really?
Yep. And then
Why were they fucking with
hook.
It?
It didn't have no hook.
Oh.
And that's why I did the hook, because
you did the hook for Do It Again?
Yeah.
Dope. Oh, 12 a.m. on my way to the club.
Yeah.
Oh shit.
Yeah, that's from like a go-go record.
Yeah. Essence or
Essence, I believe. Overnight Scenario.
Yeah.
But I only heard the record one time. When I you know, I just remember the concept. I couldn't really remember them, you know, what they were saying. I know they said Waffle House, and that was really it. But
the Waffle House,
I knew that was in there and stuff. So, yeah, so we kind of started listening to the record without the hook. Then it was like, man, if we could just get a hook, we can get a hook. And then I remember being like, actually, it's this go-go hook I remember that I heard when I was at Hampton Homecoming with SMS. Yeah. And that was that. And
damn.
And he was like, you know, I remember telling him he was dropping me off in my house. And I remember saying it. And he was like, well, think about it and figure it out. And we're going to do it tomorrow. So a whole night, I'm like, I'm trying to figure out like what they were saying. You know, no YouTube, no nothing. Yeah. It was just trying to like recall, you know, what it was. And then eventually we just probably just worked it out.
Did you have to record a reference or anything or not?
Nope, never.
So once you got the hook, Beanie decided to get on the track?
No, he was on it.
He was originally?
Yeah. Now he got on it after Jay got on it. You know what I mean? And then Jay started messing with it, and then he got on it. But he passed on it for himself, kind of.
Honestly, that Do It Again got to be one of my favorite top 10 Jay-Z records of all
time. It's a classic intro.
Yeah.
That intro is insane.
And I was in Harlem at the time. I remember when it dropped, and it was just, it had like that kind of, I don't know, it kind of had that Harlem flow a little bit, that braggadocious, like really, I don't give a fuck light, you know?
That was kind of one of his, I think you could say, stepping into his you know what I mean, yeah. In that reign, like becoming the guy.
The superstar.
Yeah, right, yeah. Kinda, but rapping yeah. from that perspective, like I seen the same shit happen to Kane. Right. You know what I mean? Like yeah. he was.
Three cuts in your eyebrows.
Yeah, he was talking yeah. about the success and stuff and yeah. kind of like, I guess you could say we was like aware of like what was going on. Like, okay, this could work in the tunnel. I'm aware as far as the music going. He's aware like, okay, if I say this, they're going to, you know, they're going to yeah. react to it.
Mm-hmm.
I know they're going to say, you know, and stuff like that. So it was just like, I guess you could say, starting to get our groove in that way. Because the first album, I didn't really A&R. Our A&R'd in the sense of kind of like what G and them was doing for me. I did for that album. Like with the Clark Kent and Ski and everybody and kind of
yeah.
collected the credits, collected the information.
You were like yeah. doing almost like interning administrative work.
Yeah, exactly.
Learning the paperwork and the process of
yeah.
putting the records together.
Yeah, because I used to read credits a lot, so I kind of knew certain things.
So that's what you're doing for Reasonable Doubt.
That's what I did for Reasonable Doubt. Yeah.
So what is the story behind, like, so you have like this ear where you can spot beats, so you can know what the songs are going to be. And like, you were telling me, Jamie, that you had an ear and Dame Dash was noticing that you were picking the right beats for certain shit.
I never used to go to the studio. I used to be in. I used to do college radio. That's what I started doing first. I worked Dead President / Ain't No Nigger. Took it to number one on college radio, basically. So I was calling like the Bobitos and mm-hmm. those type of guys and Mayhems, and you know, I was calling those guys and sending them records and working it at like the. Was like CMJ, Mix Magazine, like yeah. doing that type of thing.
And you were tied in with Roc-A-Fella because your brother's with Biggs.
Yeah. Now I got tied in with Roc-A-Fella because I was friends with Cam'ron.
Cam'ron, okay.
Yeah. So I used to be with Cam, and him and Dame lived in the same building. So all of our friends, Duke the God, we went to high school together. Jim Jones, I went to high school with him.
Yeah. yeah.
Mm-hmm. My other friend Ashley, we went to school. And Cam school was like our rival. Him and Mace went to Manhattan Center. I went to Julia Richmond.
Right.
So basically, from me being around them, I would end up at Dame house once in a while. Or I see him and I'd be like, yo, play me some Jay-Z records. I want to hear some records. And he'd be like, yo, where you going? I say, I'm going to the East Side, what, AK, whatever, the projects. And he'd be like, all right, cool. And he'd take me there and just play me Politics as usual. That, you know what I mean? Like in 94. You know what I mean?
It's crazy.
It's like, I remember Jay had to change the numbers. He had to change the years on the songs and stuff. You know, I remember being like, yo, you know, you say 94. You know, it was like I had to like, you know, that was like my thing, like picking out those little small, you know, details and stuff. But so me being around, I will always have tapes, mixtapes, stretch Bobito tapes. And so one time I had the Get Money remix when it just came out.
Mm-hmm.
Junior Mafia. Yeah, the Junior Mafia one. And my man was like, yo, Dame, you never heard this. And he played. He's like, where you get that from? And then he was like, yo, I got to call Clark. You know what I mean? So, you know, he knew Clark and DJ. So he's calling Jay and stuff. He's like, yo, you heard this? And so he was impressed that I had it.
Mm.
So he was like, yo, where you get this from, man? And I was like, I taped it off the radio. He's like, you taped off the radio? You be taping the radio? What type of shit is that? You know what I'm saying? So he's like kind of still making fun of me.
That's a good Dame impression.
So he's kind of making fun of me, but he's like, yo, I need this. So I'm like, all right, cool, whatever. You can keep it. So the next time, I think I told him, like, yo, you know my brother. You know what I mean? So I told him he knew my brother, but he know my brother Bob and Dame was friends. Not really Biggs.
Oh.
You know what I mean? Because that's the best out. Biggs was younger than them. So they older. Mm. So I was like, yeah, you know my brother Bob and this and that. So he was like, oh, word? You Bob brother? And then so from that point, you know, he was kind of cool with me when he see me. But I don't see him a lot. You know, I just see him leaving the building or something like that.
Yeah.
Or if I see him and ask him to hear a record, he'll, you know, take me on a trip and play the records for me.
Wait, because you brought up Clark Kent and you brought up the remix, is that how they got Brooklyn's Finest, that beat?
Clark Kent was already, he signed Dame's, he signed Original Flavor.
Yeah. Oh, okay, okay.
Yeah, so he knew Dame since he was like 19 already. He knew Dame forever. Right. So they had a real good relationship. So that's why he was like, I'm going to call Clark. Because he's like, yo, I want the record. So he was kind of calling Jay bragging about the record. But Jay like, oh yeah, Clark played that for me. And and then I remember him like saying like the rhymes to Brooklyn Finest. Like Jay saying them to Dame, and Dame put the speaker on. And he's like, no more, Mr. Nice Guy. You know what I mean? And he's saying that. And we, me, Cam, and Thing, and Bloodshed, we all there like, oh, you know what I mean? Like, covering our mouth because we knew, you know, everybody was like, always wanted to hear new Jay. We knew how good he was, but it was like real obscure. It was like hard to find his songs and his music and the stuff until I realized it was all on Chubby Chubb tapes. But nah. It took me though, but because that was his DJ, so he would have stuff, but nobody was looking for it. So I just started buying it and stuff like that. So I ended up having a lot of Jay stuff, and then by the time the Big L song came out, the freestyle, they wanted the freestyle. Biggs was like, "Yo, my brother got it."
That was the joint on the Stretch Armstrong show.
On the Stretch Armstrong joint over the Milkbone beat. So he did that, and he told them like, "My brother got it." And then he was like, okay. So they came to my house, picked it up. And then at that point, he was just like, I would just see him every now and then. And then one day my brother was like, yo, we starting the label together. He was literally taking me home from the game, from like a basketball game. He was like, yeah, I'm gonna start a label with Dame and Jay. And I'm like, oh shit. And then he was playing music and stuff. He played me like another Jay record. I can't remember which one. I think Coming of Age. He started playing like records, you know, that they was working on and stuff. And then I'm like, holy shit, you know, not really understanding what a label is and nothing like that. Yeah, yeah. But just, you know, I just knew Jay was good. I knew he knew him because of Dame, but I didn't know that they was that cool to where they were starting the label together. Mm-hmm. So at that point, one day my brother called me and was just basically like, yo, come to 17 John Street after school. And I was like, okay, I didn't know where it was at. Somebody had to help me get there. And when I went upstairs, it was Damon, Jay, Tata, my boy Ray Ray, Garnett Reed, probably like at least like 5-6 other guys. And they was all playing their president's politics and another record. And they was trying to figure what was going to be the first single. And, you know, and I came in kind of late and they was like, yo, what you think? Then I'm like, I actually picked politics. And they was like, all right, cool. But then the one guy who was kind of trumped everything, his name was Ray Ray, because he had like, he was going to work the record at radio. So he was like, nah, let's go with this one. It got the Nas sample. Mm-hmm. You know, so they kind of roll with it. It was like, you know, DJ's going to fuck with it. Stuff like that. So that's how Dead Presidents became the first single. And by the time I left or was about to leave, Dame was like, yo, you going to work or not? Mm. He just asked me, you know, I'm like, am I going to work or not? What do you mean? Like, you know, this is, in the, you know, he's like, yo, you want to work? I was like, yeah. He's like, all right, come back to tomorrow after school. And I was every day after that.
Who gave you the name hip hop?
Dame. Because of all those events of me constantly coming through with stuff. And my name is Kyambo. So I remember one time Jay was on Stretch and I went with them. And, you know, he's shouting everybody out. And he come to me and he's like, shout out to Big's brother. And then he was like, yo, how you say your name again?
Oh shit.
And then I was like, after later on he said that, and I was like, Kyambo. He was like, all right, cool, we gotta get you a nickname. and then later on Dame was like, oh yeah, that's hip-hop. He always got some hip-hop. That's hip-hop. He know everything about hip-hop. That's hip-hop. And you know, he went through a few other names, but right on 72nd BBQs.
Wow. That was shit too. BBQ for 7 seconds.
Yep, get
them still
big,
there.
The big Texas size joints. Yeah, that's exactly what happened. That right there.
So explain to me what A&R is for motherfuckers who don't know it, because I feel like we all knew kind of and heard about A&Rs in the 90s, mm-hmm. 2000s.
I mean, the role definitely has changed since then.
Yeah, but I don't even know if A&Rs exist even now for labels or I don't, you know what I'm saying? Like,
nah, they definitely still do. Somebody got to, collect the stuff.
Yeah.
I remember when I met Pimp C and I told him I was the A&R, he was like, man, he said, so you collect the tapes. He said, because my A&R only come pick up the dats. He was like, you know what I'm saying? He was like, I was like, nah, I pick the beats. I do this, I do that. He was like, well, ain't nobody picking my beats. You know what I'm saying? Like, he was kind of like being aggressive because I'm telling him what the job of an A&R is. Yeah, you know, yeah. So he's thinking I want an A&R for him. But I was just calling him to be on a record or something like that. But so basically, technically, it really means artist development, artist scouting and repertoire. So the artist scout part is finding the artist. The repertoire is finding the music. Mm-hmm. Mm. So it's like you have to do both. You got to find artists and then you got to find songs. Back in the days, finding songs was a more difficult part because you needed songwriters and producers. And you had to. So it was a harder job at that point where now most things are self-contained. So you just kind of doing more of the scouting part. Mm-hmm. And then you want to like service it, manage it, help it out. So I like to say that it's a manager, but for the album, right. So for the artist, for the project. So it's like, you got to find a project, but then you also got to deliver it. So your job is the delivering of it and making sure that it's, it's done, basically.
In hip hop, it's like in hip hop, right? It's basically an A&R is like finding the beats for the artists. And then with R&B, is it like developing the artists and like kind of honing in their sound?
Yeah, R&B is harder just because it's songwriting on every song most of the time.
Right.
So you got to find the top liners, songwriters, then you got to find the beats. And then it's a lot of demoing, like somebody else making the records for you. And then you got to play a bunch of records for people to where like what they do now for bigger artists, they'll do like song camps and just have like 15, 20 producers and songwriters in one big studio just making music for
Rihanna.
Say. Yeah. Like, I think they might have created it. So they'll find a studio with like 7 rooms and people in every room and they going through and they making stuff and they giving them topics and they going over and it's not just like random people. It's like the best of the best.
That's
all in there kind of like just for that purpose.
It's like a war room and they're just brainstorming.
Right, exactly. So as an A&R in that case, you picking the people to come into the room. Mm. You picking the producers for them to work with. So you might not be picking the beats no more. You might be picking the producers to connect them with and having those relationships and being able to do that. So it's different roles. Like, I never had to pick a beat for Kanye, obviously.
Right.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But with Jay, I had to pick, a lot of beats, because it's like he's not going to make none of them. Anything else that I didn't pick was because they made it on the spot, basically. Or a couple beats might have got to him just randomly.
So you were constantly listening to beat tapes from different producers, from everybody.
Yeah.
Just constantly. And then you would hear a beat and you're like, that's for Beanie. So then you kind of put it over on the Beanie side. You hear another beat, that's Cam. You hear another one that's
Bleak.
That's Bleak.
Nah.
Nah?
I would do it one at a time, basically. So if I'm doing, because the way albums had to be made back then, you had to make them way before they came out.
Right.
Yeah. So you had to have like, I might be finished an album and this might not be out for another 2 months. So I'm starting working on the next record. So only if a beat really sounds like Beans will I really save it in that case. But
So you're focusing on the artist.
At the time.
So if like Cam is coming out with an album, you're like, all right, I need to find all these beats and that Cam can fuck with that's gonna make his album hot.
Yeah, but it got difficult because, like I said, once it got to the point where we had so many artists that they was overlapping, obviously. But before it was like three artists, so it was easy for me to do.
Yeah, yeah.
And I only was really doing two. I was really only doing Beans and Jay.
Yeah.
Was ever.
Then he was doing Bleak, and G was doing like a Mill and other stuff.
A Mill.
Yeah. What the hell happened to a Mill?
What the hell happened to a Mill?
I was like thinking out loud.
Gone. Was ever a beat that you try to pick for Jay and he was like, nah, this ain't that hip hop? And you had to like really force that fucking beat.
I mean, it's a lot that didn't make it that I tried to force it and other people used them. It's a lot of beats. Still Not a Player, had that, had Whoa.
Wait, let's go back. Still Not a Player.
Yeah.
Big Pun?
The Big Pun?
Yeah,
record?
The Big Pun.
The original or the remix?
The remix. Yeah, really? The Sean C. joint.
Jay would have killed that shit.
Yeah, that. Whoa
by Black Rob.
Wow.
Oh, so shit. Whoa,
I think Bleak passed on that.
Oh, shit.
We had what was a couple other ones?
You told me that.
Lights, Cameras, Action. I remember.
What?
I was kind of mad. Yeah, he said it was too slow.
What?
That was like 107 BPM.
I was like, what you mean it's too slow? Like,
who said it was too slow?
Jay.
Jay?
Mm-hmm.
That's crazy.
Yeah, he was like, it was too slow. Yeah, it was a couple because that was, yeah, because it was Bink. Yeah, it was Bink. It was, yeah, I got it from Bink. But let me see.
Wait, so when those songs, like when Mr. Cheeks dropped Lights, Camera, Action, and you heard it, were you like, man, I knew this
was a hit.
Put your hands up. Like,
yeah.
You were just, are you mad or you just frustrated or nah?
Nah. I'm never really like, kind of like grudges or being like, oh, fuck, I told you so. You know what I mean? It's like, I'm already moving on to the next record. Because it's just, sometimes it's just like only 14 songs. So it's like whatever's best for the record, more or less.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that a record just got to motivate them. That's why like any hook I ever did was because I had to convince them to do the record.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So it was like, okay, come up with a hook. And then I would have to like figure it out.
So you did that on Do It Again.
Mm-hmm.
What other records did you do? I heard you did it with Big Pimp and you made a hook for that. We doing Big Pimp and we spending cheese. Check them out now. Big Pimp and on BLAD. We doing Big Pimp and up in NYC. It's just that Jigga Man, MC and B-U-N-B. Yo. Mm-hmm.
You told me that was a hard, hard self to Big to Pimp C, right?
Oh yeah, yeah. Pimp C, yeah. He didn't want to do that record.
Why he didn't want to work with Jay?
He didn't want to do Big Pimpin' the record.
That too.
Wait, why did he want to work with Jay?
He was a big Tupac fan.
Ah, okay.
Hmm.
And Tupac had just passed away not too long ago, and he heard of something.
Yeah, there was.
You know what I mean? I guess because Pac said something about Jay, so he's like, I'm not fucking with him because Pac ain't fucking with him and stuff like that. But once he got past that, he thought like Jay was saying,
This is the Road Podcast. You can say pause.
Okay, pause. He thought Jay was saying that he was playing with his dick in the truck.
Oh, play with it quick in the truck.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So he's like, man, I'm not getting on a song with another man talking about playing with himself in the truck. What type of shit you trying to have me doing? Hip hop, man, young hop, you my boy, but damn, what you trying to have me doing, man? He said, that's like career suicide. So I was like,
that's not like that Michael Jackson and Prince shit. Your blood is mine.
You gonna say what? You gonna say that to me?
To me?
So I cleared it up. I was like, nah, he said, I let her play with it quick in the truck. He said, I could see that. That makes sense now. You know what I'm saying? And then he was like, he started, so then he kind of got closer to doing it. But then it'd be like, man, I don't know, man. This beat is funny. This is like a funny beat you sent me, man. This is a funny beat. You know what I mean? So he literally told me, he said that, man, I had to figure it out, man. I had to call up Big Gip and ask him, could I borrow his flow?
Oh, shit. Big Gip from the Goody Mob.
From the Goody Mob.
Yeah. Really?
Yeah. He said I had to call Big Gip and ask him, could I borrow his flow because... shit, I couldn't just come on it like I be doing it. He said I needed to get it, good it, how you do it. You know what I mean? And that's why the choppiness. Yeah. That's what he called it. He said I had to be more choppier. and stuff, because he was like really, like he really was well aware of what he was doing. Like he really like broke down his whole flow and his whole thing. Like I rap with a vocal tone, a run, with the choppiness of Scarface and the southern drawl of Willie D.
Yeah.
Oh wow.
And he did it for me, like in my face, like. I'm about a big long cat a lot like a, and then he started like sounding like Run and then adding the inflections and then, you know what I'm saying, doing the whole thing. And I'm like, holy hell. You know what I mean? But then I'm realizing like, damn, he made all the beats. He's singing on all the hooks.
For UGK. Yeah.
Even on Big Mike records, he's singing on the hooks. Or, you know what I mean? I'm just a player and stuff. You know what I mean? Not that one, but having things. Yeah, so he's singing on hooks and stuff like that, and you know, he had like a whole nother level of skill set. So by the time he did it and me going back and forth, I remember he was like, man, I'm gonna do this for you, Young Hop, because you've been keeping real with me from day one. Because I've been at that point, I done, like, when he asked me about the A&R, that was like 5 years ago. Yeah, before that. So I was already trying to get them to do another record before. So I kind of knew him, you know what I mean, back and forth and stuff. So he was cool with me. You know, the video was great. I got to hang with him the whole time and stuff.
I mean, that was the record that, you know, like, I'm sure you was a big UGK fan, but that really, that crossed him over to the next level.
And the whole Big Pimpin' thing, that came from, you're a big Tupac fan, right?
A bigger Dog Pound fan.
Okay. I'm sorry, that's what I mean. Dog Pound fan. I remember that was the sound.
Yeah, I'm a big Tupac fan.
No, but I was gonna say.
I was just saying that because it's Dog Pound.
I was saying, you told me you geeked out when you saw Tupac in Harlem one time buying cigarettes or whatever.
Because Big Pimpin' was on the
a white ass.
The Above the Rim soundtrack.
Yep, Big Pimpin', yep, for sure. Yeah.
And so that kind of like you derived Big Pimpin'.
Mm-hmm. The name. It just kind of was like, I guess that kind of made me think of them as well. Mm-hmm. So I think I might have thought of them after I thought of the hook. Mm-hmm. And then I thought about them for the record and stuff, because he was just kind of like playing the record, and it was just a beat that he just kept playing, like trying to figure it out. Maybe he was writing to it, because that's what he do, but it was just one of those, like a random night with Timbaland, because that's what he was doing. We would constantly go to his studio. Like, we never worked with Timbaland in Bassline. We would just go to, he worked in Manhattan Center, which is upstairs from the Hammerstein Ballroom.
Oh wow.
So it's like right there. So we used to see shows. Like while shows going on, you could just walk right out the studio and go right on the balcony and see the show.
Wow.
Yeah, so we would be in his studio a lot. And that was like where, you know, Static, Leah, and everybody would be there as well, different nights or sometime the same time.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Did you have a relationship with Leah?
Oh yeah, for sure. Definitely. I was with her. I was with her the day. I was with her the day before she died.
Mm.
Like I was, yeah, cause we was,
Was it the video shoot?
Yeah. I seen the video.
For Rock the Boat?
Yeah. Like I seen her dance. It was in a regular gym, but I don't know how they make it look like they was on water and stuff like that. But yeah, I seen that part. It was a couple parts because, I was in Miami with Beans and Bleak recording, and then Dame came down because he was, though him and my brother came down to check on us, but Aaliyah was doing a video at the same time. So I was like probably not doing as good of a job as they thought, because we went to do a Beans and Bleak album.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow, that sounds crazy.
Yeah. There's going to be a duo album?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, so shit. We was flying out there to get away. Just was there. It was just nobody, the producers. It was just in like beats from Kanye, beats from everybody else.
Holy shit.
So.
Wait,
that sounds insane.
Wait, so the concept was a Mef Bleek and Beans album produced by Just and Kanye West?
Yeah.
Whoa.
Mm-hmm.
That's crazy.
Yeah. Yeah, we had other producers too, because we had a lot of Philly producers who were constantly like, they will work with and kind of bring songs from Philly when they come to the city and stuff. So they started getting rapport with certain guys. But Yeah, so we wasn't, the studios was expensive. It was like a big operation. Like me and Lenny, we were staying all in Bell Harbor. Not Bell Harbor, but by the yacht club, like right over, yeah, like right there.
They expanded the budget for sure.
Yeah, so we had like literally was renting like apartments. Like we had like the whole summer. We was down there for 3 months. And they might have came, so when she back, like August? Yeah, like August, like end of August. So they came and they didn't feel like it was productive, but I already kind of aborted mission and we started working separately. So that's how we made Rock the Mic down there, because Bean started going with his guys, Bleak started going with his guys, so he started making like Hypnotic and a lot of the records around here, a lot of them records for that album. And Bean started making State Property records. And that became productive, but they was kind of mad. And so when I got to the video, she knew they was mad because they was talking about it.
Aaliyah.
Yeah. So she came to me and was like, I got a break and I'm going to come to the studio to hear what you're doing. And so she came to the studio. She heard the records and she heard Rock the Mic and was bugging. She was like, wow, I never heard no song like this before. Could you get me a beat like this? Could you do, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So just did her beat like that. And she was like, I'm recording that when I come back.
Mm.
And because she used to like, we used to smoke. So she would like hide. She'd hide behind me and smoke and shit. So I remember having some ill weed. And she was like, please give me some of that. Like, please, please give me some of this weed, da da da. And she was like, I'm coming back. When I'm coming back, I'm going to do that song. And, you know, we're going to get high. So it was like, I had that ounce of weed for like, I wouldn't touch it. Like, because, you know, she, the next thing you know, I'm at the studio. Because she leave one day, and I might not even left the studio. I might have still been in the studio from when she left. And then next to you know Ross, Rick Ross and them, because I knew him already. Because he would come to the sessions and rap with State Property.
No way.
I never even knew this.
Yes.
That's crazy.
Mm-hmm.
So this is 02?
Yep. 01.
01?
Okay. Yeah, because this is before September 11.
Right.
Yeah, so we were supposed to leave September 11th. That was the day we was leaving. No, we were supposed to leave September 10th. So we had that was the last day of the studio. And our flights was September 11th. So it was like, by the time we woke up to leave, we were left the studio. Could be like, we're going to work all night. We're going to use that time to the end. Like, we're going to use that time until the last session is over. And then we leaving. And then, so that ended up going into the 11th. By the time me and Beans got to the room, the towers, that shit was hitting into the towers and stuff. So we had to stay down there for another 2-3 weeks because there was no flights.
Right.
And nothing like that. By the time we drove, we had to drive all the way back.
Oh, shit.
Yep. His moms came and got us in North Carolina. Somebody took us to North Carolina and his mother came and picked us up. Damn. And we just, you know, made it all the way back. And then that's when I finally smoked her. That ounce. I was like, okay, now we ain't got no more weed. We was on that road, you know. But yeah, so it was, so she was real cool. I spent a lot of time with her, like in the Hamptons and stuff like that.
She was out and about. Her and her brother were out in the clubs.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
When Mark Ronson was spinning.
Yeah, Mark and Samantha, like, oh, they yeah. whole team, yeah.
That was like, they were like the Brat Pack at that time.
Yeah,
100%. In New York. It was like Mark Ronson. I think he was dating
Kadada Jones. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then you saw Aaliyah, you saw her brother.
Mm-hmm.
And then, yeah, it was just like you saw Cassidy around and it was,
yeah,
that whole crew.
Yeah, no, it was definitely. That's when,
and then that was the time when like Dame was actually like, yo, hip hop was being integrated in the clubs.
Yeah.
And you saw hip hop artists for the first time in like New York clubs,
mm-hmm.
like in like these like
yeah,
really exclusive hip hop clubs,
Soho clubs,
not even the clubs, but also in the Hamptons, like Conscious Point
for sure,
and on Jetties.
Yeah,
I just see them up in there.
Yeah, and they would, and you saw them with like supermodels, and I mean like Sports Illustrated models,
yeah,
with like with Dame Dash and everything. It was like, it was crazy because you never thought it would integrate like that.
Yeah. I remember I see Shine used to start to be at a lot of them spots back then. And he was like early.
Yeah.
Moving around in that Soho because he was cool with like Richie and him.
Richie Kiefer.
Yeah.
And Jetski. Yeah.
That was Jetski. That was a dope time, man.
Nah, it was.
Yeah.
That was like 2000, like probably. Like,
yeah. Early 2000s and shit.
You mentioned Rick Ross. Like, I know you kind of like skipped over it, but like for him to be around that time, who was he connected with?
I knew him. I knew his manager.
Okay.
I knew his manager. His name is Red. Red and Rue. Those are my guys. I knew them from like a homie I knew from the streets who was like, yo, when you go to Miami, holla at these guys. And they used to come and pick me up, take me to Miramar and all around the place and stuff like that. And then maybe one of the second or third times I came out, they was like, yo, we got an artist. We want you to hear. And it was Ross. So I heard him probably like 98.
Wow.
97. I mean, you know, way back then. Like, yeah. And then they had Circle House. They took me to Circle House Studios. And that's why I ended up booking it later on. Because I was like, I got to come down here and record. So as soon as I got enough clout to be like, hey, I want to record in Miami with Beans and Bleak. And
right.
So we did that. And that kind of like turned to some good records and stuff. And, you know, Rock the Mic and a couple of Freeway records, a couple Beans records from his album, Purple Rain. Yeah, it was a nice amount of like work done, but definitely not what we intended to do. So she kind of looked out, because when she came down and saw the stuff, she kind of like gave me like a vote of confidence. Like, yo,
right,
you're dope. You really know what you're doing. Don't worry about that shit.
You know, yeah, because you was getting pressure from them, right?
Like, yeah, exactly.
Like, we put out this budget for y'all, and y'all fucking around in Miami.
Right.
Y'all supposed to give me a Bleak and Beans album, and these motherfuckers ain't recording together. What you doing?
Yeah, because they couldn't agree on beats. Yeah, they couldn't agree with the tracks.
Right.
Like, Beans like a beat, then he won't like it, then he like it, and he, you know, so they might have agreed on, like, two.
Damn.
And that might have been the Hypnotic record and another record that probably ended up on Bleak album.
It's funny, like, the things you hear about Aaliyah, that sounds like something Aaliyah would do. Would be like, you got all this pressure on you.
For sure.
She's like, let's go to the studio. Yeah. And then she makes it like, you know.
Smoke a little bit.
Smoke some weed and they're like, yo, this is some shit. I want to beat like this. Yeah. She seems like the type that would do that shit.
Yeah. No, definitely.
And turn the energy all around.
All around, yeah.
Like, that's baby girl, right? That's that's her.
Yeah, for sure. Because even when that night, I was trying to get her the weed that night, but we couldn't find them. Like, we couldn't find the video. It was like, you know, like when you go to a video shoot, you can like see it before you get there.
The
you
big
know,
light.
Okay, yeah. There's a truck, here's that. But it was on a college, and we circled the whole college trying to find it, but they was like inside doing the under the water thing in the tank. So she was like in the tank and stuff, and she hit me later like I was in the, you know, she was like in the tank. She couldn't really, what you call it. So that always tripped me out that, you know, the water, the shit, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And the whole thing, it was like a video was on, she was dancing on the water. It was like, you know, it was like a lot of that going in there. Like, I heard that record before her, Rock the Boat. Like, I told her about it.
Oh, no.
Really?
Yeah. I remember telling us, because I was
mad. What did you hear, the beat or a reference track?
I heard the reference track, Static in them. I heard it.
Ooh.
Yeah, R.I.P. I heard it from them, or maybe Tim or something. And I don't think she was like really, because Tim didn't do that. So I heard it from Static in them, I believe. And then I remember being like, yo, it's just one record. That's like, you know. So I remember telling her about the record before. Just off of like, you know, just hearing it.
Just giving, just like, and she just recorded it. She checked
it out. Yeah, I mean, she was going to record it anyway, but I just remember being like, yo, it's a record that they got. That's a crazy, you know. And she was like, yeah, I know Static is incredible. You know what I mean? But, because I managed Static.
You did?
Yeah.
Damn. Static Major, bro.
Yeah, R.I.P.
Yeah, man. R.I.P. Yeah.
Did it just come natural to manage the producers that you were like, you know, because you were A&Ring and for the artists, and so it just made sense to have like kind of like an army of producers under your wing that you could just kind of pull beats from?
Not at first. No. At first, it was kind of like a conflict
of interest.
Of interest.
Because then you were just like, well, let's just keep pushing Just Blaze beats because I'm managing Just Blaze.
Right. Or this is before I thought of that. Because the first ones I was managing was, or thought to manage, was Buck Wild.
Mm.
Wow. So Buck Wild and Alchemist. Wow. Like, those are the first two producers that I knew. And this is from like 96, 97. I mean, Alchemist 97. I knew Buck before I even got in the music industry. So
it's from Harlem, right?
The Bronx.
But, oh, shit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I knew his cousin. And his cousin was basically saying, he seen that I like hip hop and was like, yo, my cousin is a DJ because I had all these mixtapes. He was like, what's his name? He was like, Buck Wild. I was like, oh, I know Buck Wild, DJ Buck Wild. I got his mixtape.
Mm-hmm.
And he was like, yeah, I'm going to have him, you know, I'm going to introduce you to him because he used to come around the way. So he introduced me to him. So I used to go to Buck House and just watch him make beats and stuff like that. So that's how I had the woe in most of his beats.
Wow.
And also every Alchemist beat. Everyone, Keep It Thorough, all of those could go under that same question.
We gonna make it.
Yes, everyone. That was like, I used to go to his dorm. Like I had his dat.
How did you find
his master dat with all his
beats.
How'd
you find an Alchemist?
He was with Premier one day, and we was doing Where I'm From, and Jay and them just left. They left the studio and was like, hey, get Premier to do some cuts. I was like, all right, cool. I called Premier. He's like, all right, come to D&D and I drive over there with you, you know, when I finish doing what I'm doing. So when I got to D&D, he was working on something, I don't remember, but it was a white kid just sitting there smoking and stuff. They was just smoking. And I smoked, but I didn't smoke a lot around Jay and them at that time. This is like 98.
Why was that?
I was trying to be professional, you know. I didn't want them to think I was like a klutz or some shit like that. Or if something go wrong, they'd be like, oh, you always high. So I wasn't really,
You know Dame would have said some shit like that.
Yeah. For sure. Like, and they wasn't smoking.
Right.
So they didn't smoke. So it was like, it was easy not to smoke. But I still did. I only smoked with Boogie Blind.
Just really? Blind, bro.
Yeah. Wait, where did you smoke with Boogie Blind?
Shit, we smoked in motherfucking Foster Projects or Morningside Park. We'd get a bag and go all the way to Morningside and go light up.
Oh, that's incredible.
Wait, how did you link up with Boogie?
I played ball with him. I knew him.
Harlem, really?
Yeah, I knew him. We both went to Millbank together.
Right,
so,
right.
So I knew him and we had like a mutual kind of like best friend.
Because he was going to maybe go professional kind of. He was like really good.
He was good. He could have went Division One. But I think he ended up having to go to junior college. So him and my boy Alfred, like Alfred went to my school, and him and Blind was like lived across the parking lot from each other in Foster. So we was going to basketball camp.
Mm.
And I'm still like maybe junior high school. No, I'm high school now, like ninth grade maybe. And we spend the night at Blind House. So he's like, yo, we can all stay at my house because, you know, like when you got a bus ride or something like that, you got to get up early and stuff. So we like, yo, let's just stay, everybody stay at his house and stuff because, you know. So we go to his house, you know, we go buy some Chinese food. We're about to go upstairs and kick it. We go in this room. This nigga got 2 12s and a mixer and the whole setup. I'm like, nigga, I didn't even know you DJ. I'm like, yo, you DJ? He was like, yeah, I DJ sometimes, you know.
Sometimes.
Yeah, so I was like, nigga, we got to make a tape, you know, because we going to camp. So I'm like, yo, we got to make a tape. So that night, you know, he DJing, we made a tape. I'm requesting all the songs. I had to go to my boy house to go get some records. And this is like a Daylight, Break of Dawn, Trends of Culture, you know what I mean? Like around that time. Like
03,
04. Wow. No. Offhand the Trends of Culture.
Daylight. 93, you mean 93? You said
03. Oh, 93, I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I was
yeah. 93, my bad.
I was like, 03 Trends of Culture?
Yeah. What remix is that?
Yeah. My bad.
Yeah. So from there on, we became real cool because we realized that we really like hip-hop. We really like music. Because everybody did when you're young. It's just a normal thing. Yeah, but then you start to see the ones that really like it more, the ones that's like going downtown. And I was like a Steve. I used to steal... Only stole tapes though. I ain't wasn't like a booster or nothing.
I don't. Where from HMV?
Yes, sir.
That's me too. that was the best place to steal.
Which one? On 72nd, right?
Yes. Yeah. Yo, on Broadway, hey, right?
Yeah, Broadway. I did that one all the time, and I did 86 once and got busted.
You did?
For a fucking Big Daddy Kane album. Like later on, too. Like look like a job for type shit.
It's funny, you and Cricket would probably have been friends if you guys had crossed paths. Because you guys are both cool with Boogie Blind and stealing from the same fucking store.
Yeah, because I was right there. I went to Joan of Arc.
Oh, you went to Joan? I went to Calhoun.
Yeah.
So you was on, you was right on 79th, right?
Nah, 90,
wait, Joan of Arc?
Joan of Arc's on 91st.
91st.
Oh. Yeah, and Columbus.
And Columbus.
Yeah.
I was on 81st and West End.
Gotcha.
I got a full scholarship to Calhoun.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And I remember I used to have to always walk by Brandeis.
Oh,
and I'd be like, fuck, man. Like, you know, either when they coming from the train from 86, I'd be like, fuck. And I'd be like, I know they're going to fuck with me, man. So I was like, I used to always try to avoid Brandeis.
Yeah, Brandeis. Because it was like a couple like rough blocks over there.
Yeah, a little bit.
Around by like
Brandeis. On Amsterdam.
Yeah, on Amsterdam.
That's what his story's about. Motherfuckers getting jumped
on.
Brandeis. Like random. Like, you be trying to be like, it's got Misfield cookies and all that stuff. And it's like movie theaters. And it's just like, because it's like, that's Upper West Side. It's like probably the most prestigious place in America, damn near. One of them, you know what I mean? Them type of buildings. Like,
But there's a couple projects on Amsterdam.
I'd like to say that, yeah.
Yeah, right there.
Oh, no, that's definitely. Amsterdam projects, that's crazy.
Yeah, I mean, I got lumped the fuck up. I almost got lumped up there. You did,
because we won, and my coach was like, "Yo, when we had a championship game, he was like, yo, don't bring no bags." He said, "We go in there with our
just sneakers and
going there with our jerseys on, and we not even." He said, "When we leaving right after the game, I'm gonna come back and get the trophies." Hey, yo, so our game was over and we just left and went right toward the joint, like over by Tower Records. We just walked right out and just was like, they was like, yo, they couldn't even react because they didn't even know. They was like, where they going? Yeah. They thought we was coming back. Then we was like, we just kept going. That's answering their projects,
Those high school games, they always try to set it.
Yeah. Oh, for sure.
Yep. Always try to set it.
That was by King.
Oh, King was,
yeah. Yeah, that was by Martin Luther King. That's a whole
King was bad,
thing.
Too.
Yeah, King was like, because they had Brooklyn. They had like the Brooklyn guys there, the Sectacons and all that.
Oh, they did.
Oh, yeah. Shit.
But King was right next to LaGuardia, right?
Yep. Across the street.
Yeah. Because that was the thing, is LaGuardia was this really, like, like prestigious art
school. Fame. Fame. It was Fame. It was based on the, well,
LaGuardia. So you had like all these artistic kids, like nerds.
That's where Nicki went.
Nicki Minaj.
Yeah.
Oh.
She went to LaGuardia.
And then you had King, which was like one of the toughest high schools.
Yeah.
And they were like right next to each other.
That was crazy.
Yep.
Wow. Yeah. It was
that's a crazy time, man.
It's such a small world.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Y'all could have been like besties, man.
Because I always went to like, that, you know, that park, because that was like the GOAT park. You know,
that's right. That's on my block. Yeah.
Yeah.
On 97 in Amsterdam.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then my brother and them, they used to drink under your building right there. He used to drink right there with Big Face Gary and.
Oh, I went to high school with Gary.
Yeah. He used to drink right there. They'd drink Bacardi Limon right there. With like Bob Beto used to come through sometimes.
Really?
Yeah. It used to be Gary.
I think Lord Sear would
Lord
be
Lord Sear was there. They were snapping on him. Cotty.
Cotty live in my building.
Cotty was there.
That's a
Curious.
Curious George. Yeah, walking like a duck.
Curious George was like our representation.
Really?
For Uptown. Like at one time, yeah, that was like all he had. It was like thank God, like pre Big Al. Yeah. It was like Curious George.
That's crazy. You're right though, right?
Yeah, because I remember being like, yo, I seen these guys before. Mm-hmm. Like I seen the guy with the afro. I seen them on 91st Street. Like, you know what I mean? Talk about Lord Sear. You know what I'm saying? Like, you started seeing people that you seen in the street on the video.
See them on the videos and video music box.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, at the show.
You know how
stuff.
Proud we were? Like, how, like, proud we were when Uptown shit came out?
I could imagine, man.
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
I remember that summer. We were so happy.
Flexing on motherfuckers.
The Uptown shit. We were Uptown. We were like, oh. I was like, yo, Curious George from my building.
I know his mom.
And I used to call it Rocksteady Park because the Rocksteady
Park.
Anniversary.
They used to have the Rocksteady jams there.
Yeah.
So we'd be like, Rocksteady Park? Mm-hmm. Like, yo, we're going to be on a map, Curious George.
Yeah.
And then nothing happened.
And you had that banging, Spanish restaurant across the street.
El Malecón.
El Malecón.
Yeah.
We used still to go there. We used to go there a lot.
Yeah. It's the best roasted chicken with that lime sauce.
Yep. Well, I got a picture with me, Jay, and everybody at that's where we at.
At El Malecón?
Yeah.
Really?
On Instagram, yeah.
Yo.
Yeah, I need that picture. Just shirt right here.
Yo, such a small world, yo.
Now, you were close. I mean, shit.
No, we used to go to that shit all the time. Like, that was like a spot. Like, my brother used to love that joint. Just get that half a chicken.
Yeah, the half chicken.
Half chicken bag.
With yellow rice and black beans. That. Yeah.
Like Dino's.
That was the shit right there.
Yeah.
Wow, man. Such a small world.
Yeah, I was right there. Because I'm from 119th Street in Lenox. So I'm by Mont Morris Park around that area and stuff.
Mm-hmm. Line is like 116, right?
Yeah, he's from 116.
116.
Yep. Yeah.
I remember when I was rapping, when I was trying to rap, I was super young.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
That's crazy.
He was my DJ. We would like go through routines.
Nah, because I probably remember him like talking about you.
Really?
Or going to like work with y'all, you know what I'm saying? Like that type of stuff. Like, cause he, you know, it was like he had like dual lives, you know what I'm saying? Where it's like we'd be playing ball, smoking in the hood, and then like I went and seen, you know, next thing you know, we got equipment, and then next thing you know, he like, yo, call me upstairs, and we go upstairs, and then we go on the Rock Raider house. Rock Raider lived upstairs.
Right. That's crazy.
Yeah, the gold turntables. And stuff like that, you know what I mean? So, I only seen it and stuff. So then, next thing you know, I seen him like a few years later. I go to his house. He got like a room full of equipment because he just won the two back to back.
Yeah,
tournament. You know what I mean?
The Vestax.
Yeah, the Vestax joints. Yeah, yep. He won those, and he's like, "Yeah, they gave me these Pro Tools. I don't even know what to do with these joints." You know what I'm saying? So I'm like, "That's what they giving you now?" You know what I'm saying? You know, back then it was like a jacket and some needles. So <I'm> like,
It was a big deal.
And he was with it back to back, so he had like four turntables, two this, two that, two mixers.
He couldn't even fit all that shit in his crib.
Nope.
And you know, it's like it was his mom's crib, right?
Yep. Yeah.
So you had all this equipment, and then you had his mom's furniture. Mm-hmm. So he had like all this old school 70s furniture, and like Vestax shit, and he'd be smoking in his crib, and we'd just be watching. Like all the fucking turntablists, we be watching the DMC videos over and over.
Yeah, he always had them joints. Yeah.
Yo, you sure you never met Hop?
It's crazy because when
it just sounds really close.
I never met Asian people growing up. I would have known.
You could have been Rock, bro. You could have been Roc-A-Fella if you played your cards right.
All
right.
I don't know about that.
But you know what I do remember? I remember like y'all names. From like flyers and stuff like that.
The lyrics to go thing
was seeing like Crooked. Now, like I remember the names, like when
I
started seeing the show, I was like, yeah, I remember these names. You know what I'm saying? But never like in the sense of like being at a party or something like that. But,
yeah, I mean, we were like so like unsigned. We were like really unsigned, and so by the time. I don't know. I kind of want to put the pieces together because when I met him, he had no turntables, and he was focusing on ball, but ball wasn't working out for him.
Right.
And he would come to my crib to practice, and I was just like, "Yo, how are you so nasty DJing and you don't have turntables?"
Right.
And I'm like, "You need to get turntables, blind." He's like, "You think so?" And I'm like, "Yo, stop fucking around."
Was he in high school?
No. This was a little bit later. So then I think.
Yeah, so he had turntables earlier, but I guess they wasn't like...
Maybe he sold them or he got rid of them or some shit.
Yeah, I think so. Or he might have... It was something he didn't have. It was either... No, he had a full set, for sure.
I'm telling you, Blind is like a fucking... He's a low-key genius.
Yeah, he is.
Like, I've never seen someone as talented as him. He got beats, too.
Yeah, no, for sure.
He got some crazy 100%. Beats, too.
He put me up on a lot of samples, like, nah, this is this. This is that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, the Isaac Hayes joints, the you know, the DJ Hollywood joint.
Ike's Love.
Yeah, he put me up on a lot of them joints and stuff, and just, you know, like, early, when he was, like, between him and my other guys, S&S.
SNS.
That's like my brother, basically.
And he was killing the mixtapes at the time, right?
Yeah.
I'm about to say, you knew all the mixtape DJs from back then, man.
Yeah.
That's how you got the hip-hop.
I really just knew S.
Because it was big. Buck Wild and S.
Oh, yeah, yeah, you're right. I do know Buck. I knew Buck. I knew S. I seen Kid Capri.
Did you know Ron G?
I didn't know Ron G. But I knew, like the other guys from, like, the hood, like the Action Packs and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Like, but my favorite was always, like, I don't know if you remember, like, Double R.
Yeah. Double R, yeah.
Remember Double R?
Yeah. Like, that was, like, my favorite. I got all their tapes. But, you know, but those type of guys. Oh, but the DJs that I didn't know was, like, the I would see, like D-Nice. Like, I knew D-Nice and Mick Boo. Like, I knew them. Like, the Boogie Down Production BDP, DJs. Because they were all, they live really in my block. You know what I mean? Mick Boo still live on my block right now.
Oh, yeah?
So it was like, yeah. And D-Nice was like 118th Street, like a block away and stuff. Shit. Like his grandmoms, because they cousins.
Mm-hmm.
So their grandma lived like a block away. So I see them. I would see like the Jungle Brothers, Sammy B,
mm-hmm.
Red Alert.
Mike G,
very. Yeah, Red Alert. Mm-hmm. I see them. They were from like my neighborhood. So I would see those type of DJs and stuff. I remember seeing Kid Capri DJ like in Mount Morris Park.
Mm.
At like
I remember the first time I seen Kid Capri DJ was at Mini Sync.
Oh, wow. That's crazy. The Mini Sync Townhouse. Them that parties was lit.
Yeah, that was like 89, 90.
Yeah, I remember those parties. I was too young to get a nose. I remember those. Because they had the same type of parties at Milbank. They used to have the parties there.
Yeah.
And I remember like one night, Bears and them would perform there. Big Daddy Kane, not Big Daddy Kane, Dougie Fresh was performing there. But it would be like a teen night to raise money type of thing. But they was getting these type of artists. It was crazy. Like,
I did, you know what's so funny? I did, I never told this story before. I did a fashion show at Mini Sync. My barber put me into this fashion show. I had like a big flat top.
So. wait. You were DJing?
No,
or you
I
were
was
walking.
You
was a runway model?
Never was a runway model, yeah. In the fashion show, my bar, because I had like a high flat top, and my bar was like, yo, I'm doing this thing. I kick a pre DJing. It's a fashion show. I need like some models. And I'm like, fuck it. All right. You got kick a pre, I do.
I'm picturing you in like the I'm picturing you in the Theo shirt from the Cosby Show. You know the Theo shirt?
No, I had a polka dot shirt. Yes.
1990.
He had the Gordon Gartrell shirt on.
Yeah, yeah.
You was on your Kwame
with my Doc Martens.
Yeah, the Doc Martens.
Yeah, he's
Doc
definitely Martin. Older than us. Right?
Like up front, man.
We rugby area. You know, we from the rugby era. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? I never wore like those type of shirts with the ear get under them joints. Hey. You know.
That's funny.
Yeah, I never. Yeah, I remember that era though, because that was like right above me. You know what I'm saying? Like the guys with the taking the box out the radio. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I think our era was like Vasquez boots, corduroys.
Yep.
The rugby.
Definitely. The thick corduroys.
The boat shoes,
Vasquez.
Woolrich Jabot jeans. You were fucking with Jabot, though.
I was fucking with Jabot, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, Jabot's. Yo, to this day, I always loved the Columbia rain suits.
Oh, yeah.
I love those.
The Holly Hansen.
I used to get all my shit from, I don't know if I remember, Tent and Trails.
Oh, come on, man. That's like the meanest spot.
Yeah.
Yeah, if you got a coat from Tent and Trails.
Mm-hmm. It was doing it.
Yeah. Even they a Paragon.
Yep. Exactly. Paragon.
I was budging to be. I was going to Wings.
Wings.
I was at Wings also, man.
Wings right there on 90.
Yeah. I was going to Wings.
No, you like had to go to Wings to get the Edwin jeans and the Pepe's.
I got the Edwin's.
Yo, the Pepe's, bro.
Damn.
Bro, yeah, now Wings was the shit. Cause that's what my school was. My school was by Wings. Like, and then they had the comic book store up there.
Yeah, upstairs.
The Big Apple Comics. Yes, sir.
Yo!
So I might have seen you at Big Apple Comics.
And they had the burger spot right next door.
I did see some Asian kids in Big Apple Comics. Okay.
Maybe one of them was here.
Oh, yeah. Shit. And they had, like, the burger spot right next door.
Yep, in the pizza shop.
Right?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Oh,
yep.
Shit.
Then they ended up in the Blockbuster across the street.
Right. God damn. This is like
Cricket is shocked.
This is
some real memory lane shit.
It is some crazy memory shit. Yeah, I don't know if motherfuckers gonna enjoy this. We're just talking about We're just talking about the block.
I'll tell him to say a cool story because we had a cool story when we were driving home from Vegas.
Well, tell about this Vegas story. This is weird.
Okay, so me and hip hop are.
No, wait. Let me set this up, though. He hits me up. He's like, yo, I'm in LA. I'm like, cool. He's like, yeah, me and hip hop drove together. And I'm like, what? And he's like, yeah. And I said, wait, in your shitty ass car? He's like, yeah.
Am I shitty pickup truck?
He's like, yo, he told me a bunch of stories. And I was like, fuck you, man. You making this up. Like, I was immediately jealous. I was like,
yeah, Tupac pickup truck from Poetic Justice. It was like one of them trips, you know what I'm saying? Like, yo, I got to drop the mail off, you know what I'm saying? I was like, all right, man, I'm going that way.
You know, and I was like, yo, hip hop is a real one if he's going to sit in that truck and just roll and just go on the road with him off. Yeah. Right?
He was like, he texted me that morning. He was like, hey, where you at? And I was like, Vegas? He goes, when you going to LA? I said, actually, in the next 2 hours. He's like, here's the address. Come pick me up. Let's go home. And I was like, okay. Yeah. And I'm like, this can't be true. So I pull up to the spot. Out comes Hop. And I was like, oh, this is really happening. And then we drove home and shit.
But you had to truck or the Dodge?
I had a truck. So yeah, we was in the truck. Damn, man.
Was the AC working?
The AC was working. Okay. This is pre the AC breaking. So yeah, so we drove, and then I was just like, all right, you know, I don't know what to ask him or speak about. He's probably tired. And then I was like, yo, did you ever meet Michael Jackson? And he's like, actually, I was with Michael Jackson working in the studio for Rock My World remix.
Oh, shit.
He said he was the only one in there. So go ahead, tell Neva, because I saved this story for Neva.
It was a Girl, Girls, Girls remix.
Oh, okay, Girls, Girls, okay, Girls, yeah. Sorry.
Because Neva came out.
Yeah. Oh. I heard about that, yeah.
The one that Trying Girls Out?
Yeah.
Michael Jackson was singing that.
Mm-hmm. Really?
I knew about that.
Oh,
yeah,
wow.
So he was singing that. I think they lost the tapes. Maybe I lost them. I don't know. I know they couldn't find them. I know they called me like 3 years ago, asked me about them. I was like, huh? I was like, it's a studio over there. I couldn't remember. I had to like pull up map thing and figure out what studio it was.
Oh, shit.
But
the part where he's like, I'm trying girls out, that was supposed to be Michael Jackson?
Yeah, he sung all that. Yeah, at the beginning.
Holy.
And this and that.
Yeah.
Yeah, he wrote it down. I got the paper. I took the paper. He was like, hold on, let's play that again. And he was just writing down what they were saying on a piece of paper and shit. I heard him making all those weird noises, like doing vocal training and shit, like making like animal noises. So like for the first 5 minutes, he's just in the booth making animal noises and stuff like that. But what happened is that we was on the Blueprint tour. Everybody was leaving. And then it was like, yo, you got to stay because Michael Jackson gonna want to do the, you know, he want to do the song.
And so were you like, come again?
Yeah. So they were like, yo, we gonna get you this. We're going to keep you here. It was the peninsula. So they're like, we're going to keep you in the peninsula. And whenever he's ready, just make sure you're there. Wow. I was like, I bet. So they finally set the date, let's say Sunday, 12 o'clock. So I'm there at 12, and they was like, nah, we're going to do it at 4. So I was like, damn, I'm at the studio already, so I'm like, fuck it, I'm going to go back to the hotel. Next thing you know, my boy Big John, like a publisher, so he was like, yo, I want to come too, you know, let me know. Because he was publishing Jay at the time, probably still is. So I was like, yeah, they pushed it back, so it's going to be like 4 o'clock. So he called me like panic, like, yo, nigga, where you at? It's 4 o'clock, nigga, Michael Jackson in the studio. Where you at? I just smoked the blood, fell asleep.
Oh, my God.
So I'm like, holy shit, I'm way in Beverly Hills. I got to get to the Valley. And I'm like panicking because I'm waking up high. I'm like, holy shit, what the fuck, where I'm at? You know what I'm saying? So then, you know, luckily they had like a car waiting for me the whole time. So I got there in time, whatever. Not in time. When I finally got there, you know, he was listening to the record. And I already had set stuff up. So he was just listening to it, figuring it out and stuff, figuring out what he had to do. He was waiting for me to tell him what he had to do. So when I get there, he's like, hey, hip-hop, what do I got to do, hip-hop? What do I got to do? I'm just like, I was so nervous. I was like, he was like, no, he's like, what do you want me to do, hip-hop? What do you want me to do? And I'm like, I was like, holy shit, what do I even tell? I was like,
Michael Jackson.
You know what I mean? So
were you nervous, right? Or no?
High energy.
He was high, tired. He just woke up.
I was nervous.
I was nervous. Yeah. I was nervous. Cause it was like, I was nervous at first, but he was like real cool. You know what I'm saying? Like, he was like, I think he knew that. He knew people. That's why he was kind of like, hey, hip-hop, what are we doing? What are we, you know what I mean? So yeah. At that point, it was like,
wait, can we go back? Like, when you got into the studio, how did he introduce himself to you? He
was like, okay, when I got there, it was like his two kids.
Uh-huh.
Babe was kids.
Oh, shit, okay.
They was running around.
Oh, like Paris?
Yep. And they had like a maid watching them.
Mm-hmm.
They like in the lounge, and he's like in the room. And they're like, yeah, he's in the room. So when I go in the room, it's like the engineer's there. And Big John is there, so he's like, you know, he's just like, hip-hop, what do I got to do? What do you want me to do, hip-hop? You know what I mean? So he's saying that, so I started laughing a little bit, and he's like, I was like, but he already knew, he heard the song and stuff, so he started writing it down and stuff. And so he was like, hey, let's go outside, you know, let's go sit down and stuff. I was like, sit down and stuff. And we went outside, you know, into the lounge, and we just started talking. So he's talking to me, like,
is he talking in the Michael Jackson voice or?
No. Nah, it's like.
What's up, son?
It was low, but it wasn't like.
It was like,
it wasn't high.
Hey, it wasn't high.
It wasn't low. It was low, but it wasn't high. You know what I mean? It wasn't like piercing or nothing like that.
Let's go outside.
Come on, hip hop. Yeah, like,
no, he told me. Hop told me that a few times when he stopped. He's like, run that back, hip hop.
Oh, yeah. And then he said, He kept saying, how does that sound? How does that sound? I was like, that sounds good. To the point where I was like, I got to throw some Do It Agains in there just so you don't think I'm just saying yeah to everything. And I was like, yeah, you can do that again. And then he was like, okay, no problem. And I was like, holy shit.
But in real life, his shit sounded good. It was just like, yo, that's good to go, right?
Like every time it was good. It was like, besides when he was making the weird noises, but other than that, as soon as he went in and do it, it was like, because he was like singing over it, so it wasn't like, it was kind of weird to him.
Yeah.
He was like, you want me to sing over them? And he was like, you want me to get in with them? And you know what I mean? Yeah. He was like, stuff like that. And I was like, nah, we're going to bring it down some, but you could just sing that part. We're going to probably take it out. He's like, oh, okay, you could do that. You know what I'm saying? So it was like that type of thing where, you know, it was cool. The only thing that was weird was that he had the biggest hands I ever seen.
Really?
Like ball player hands?
Yeah, it was like he like dwarfed my hands and it was like strong as hell.
Kawhi
like,
Leonard.
No way.
Yeah.
Oh, that's wild. Oh,
because that was like everything else seemed like it was small, but the hands was like.
Right.
Oh, he always wore gloves, right?
Yeah.
So you never really saw his hands.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yo, that's crazy. I would never
think. My boy said he had Kawhi Leonard hands.
His hands was like big and strong as fuck. I was like, damn.
That shit threw you off, right?
You have.
I'm like thinking of the Martin shit when he's just like, you know, handshake. Holy shit! But that's So when you first heard him like with his vocals,
mm-hmm.
did you get like shivers or like you're like, oh my god, he sounds.
Yeah, like me and Big John was like. We right. was like tapping each other. We was like, oh shit,
it's happening.
He's doing it. He's doing the thing. He's doing it. You know what I'm saying? It was kind of like, because he was just like, it was just like, that shit was just floating out. That was, you know what I'm saying? That shit was just like so effortless. Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was crazy. Because I never really did too many R&B sessions and really got
really?
To that part of it. Yeah, nah, I stayed away from that. I only did like one. Brandy album, Aphrodisiac.
That's an amazing album, by the way.
Yeah, thanks.
One of my favorites.
Yeah, thanks. Yep, I did that one.
Which what was it? A track?
Oh, shit. Me and G. Yep. Mm-hmm.
To me, that was like when she really found her sound, because I feel like she was young when she did a lot of her other albums.
Yeah,
and Aphrodisiac. She really like was like a little bit more mature. And
that was like
her
Full Moon, right?
That was later.
That was
oh no later. No! What was Aphrodisiac?
Aphrodisiac. That's when she started really working with Rodney Jerkins, right?
Yeah, Timbaland did a lot of it.
Okay,
actually, Timbaland did a lot of it. That's the one that had the Kanye record on there.
Talk About Our Love.
Talk About Our Love. She had a T.I. record on there. Yeah. She had a couple records on there. Kanye did a couple more on there. Mm-hmm. Timbaland.
That was a great record with Kanye.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I remember playing that shit a lot when it dropped.
Yeah,
that was a great record. Yeah. Wow, so you did that too as well?
Yeah, because that's when I got to Atlantic.
I'm about to say that, yeah.
Yeah, because when I left Roc-A-Fella, I guess the thing kind of came, like what you were saying about the beats, that became an issue for me as far as just all the artists was, it wasn't even no different kind of beats no more because they all was so much similar. You know,
it became a machine, right?
Yeah, it kind of became like, well, I didn't get that. What happened to that? What that was at?
Oh.
You know, so it was like, and then Cam, who I knew forever, and then it's Jay, who I've been working with forever. You know what I mean? So that kind of became
a thing. So they're like, why'd you give him that shit? You didn't give it to me kind of shit?
Yeah, like I never heard that. What was that? You know what I mean? Or stuff. So. Probably like around like, I really mean it.
Yeah.
And
you was dealing with boy. it was Dipset. It was Dipset.
What happened? State
Property and like Roc-A-Fella. So they was like all battling for beats at the time.
Right, yeah. But Cam would come in and be like, yo, what's this? And he'd hear a beat and he'd do it. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? He was like
hungry.
Yeah.
And he was in the studio and he was there.
Exactly. So
yeah, if I was Jay and I heard I really mean it, I would have felt some type of way too.
Yeah.
What about he was feeling some type of way about that, right?
Did something happen with Old Boy?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because that was supposed to have been like a record with a couple people on there. Uh-huh. But once Cam got it, because I remember he came in and was like, yo, you never give me no beats. And I was like, y'all got this beat. And he was like, he did it right there. And then he kind of like took it to the radio that night. And it ended with, the song wasn't even finished. He just like, when he said Guru start popping them. He said, stop it right there. He said, I'm taking this to Flex. And he took that Flex, just that part.
Before Jules got on it. Jewels got on it, right?
I think so. Yeah, I think it was before.
Because Jewels would hop, right? I think he continued that verse. Yeah.
And they did it the next day. We ended up finishing. So it was like they played it one night. The next day we was finishing it. So by the time it came out.
But when he did that, that's not normal, right?
Nah, definitely not.
And did you know he did that? Or?
Yeah, we heard it.
No, would you have approved him to cut the record in and bring it to Flex like that?
No, nah. It definitely, because first of all, we didn't know what type of record it was. We was thinking about doing a compilation album at that time.
Mm-hmm.
So it was kind of like similar to the Beans and Bleak thing. Like we started doing something else, but it ended up just like records ended up going everywhere.
So you were thinking of doing like a Roc-A-Fella compilation kind of thing?
Yeah, I was gathering beats for that.
Right.
And that was one of the beats for that. So when he came, I was like, well, we could do this one. You know what I mean? Because it could have easily just been their record on a compilation, too.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't like it had to been other Roc-A-Fella artists on it. You know, it could have just been a Dipset record. But once he did it, it kind of just shifted everything to him. It just shifted that. Like
He was getting some monster tracks at that time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
I would have. Yeah, he was, like, Jim is great. Jim always had a good ear to me. Like as far as what's going on,
Jim Jones.
Yeah.
Wait, how was he involved?
He would have to get credit for A&R on the album with me.
Oh, really?
Yeah, definitely. Like a lot of the stuff come from him.
So he was finding the beats with you.
yeah. Because even like the
is he the one? Did he bring Heat Makers to the table?
Nah, that was me.
That was you.
That was like, but. By like, what happened is that the first beat I think was "I'm Ready." I think was the first beat the Heatmakers did. I got the beat from Top Fife, right? And Guru said that I got that beat too. So I was like, "Same sample?" He's like, "Nah, the same exact beat." And then I was like, "For real?" He was like, "Yeah, this kid did it from around went to school with. This kid I went to school with gave it to me." Arson, whatever. So he was like, one of the Heat Makers gave it to him. So I'm like, he was like, so he bought them in. He's like, I'm going to call them to come through. And they were like, yeah, we did some beats with Top Five or whatever, but these are our beats. And that was it. So they came in. Guru knew them.
Heat Makers are from where, Harlem or Uptown?
Nope. They from, I think they're from Brooklyn, I think. But what it was that they went to Howard with Guru. Okay. One of them went to Howard with him. So, and then they kind of came by. They did that one record, and then they just kind of clicked with Dipset, and Dipset just went their way with them because they was kind of fighting with the Just and the Kanye stuff. You know what I'm saying? Just with the Jay and the Beans and everybody.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? So they were like, we getting our guys. You know what I mean? So they kind of tucked them for themselves.
Because Just gave them Oh Boy, right? I Really Mean It. Everyone started getting slightly territorial with Just Blaze and Ye a little bit.
Ye loved Cam.
Yeah.
So he would do anything for Cam at that point, but it was really a scheduling, a setting it up, a when to do it type of thing. Like, most of the records just happened. So it wasn't like, we need to go on with Kanye, we're going to set a time for Kanye, we're going to set time for his person. It would just happen.
Mm-hmm.
It would just be like it was a big thing with the Ace to the Izzo record, because Cam had it too. Because...
Wow, this sounds like a this sounds like a rough
war.
That's kind of like the mid, you know, that's a lot of people would say that's the beginning of their whole thing.
Who heard it first, H to the Izzo?
I don't know, because me and G was both managing Kanye.
Right.
So we both got the same beats from Kanye. He was working with Cam, I was working with Jay.
Mm-hmm.
He played it for Cam, I played it for Jay. But I played it for Jay when Jay wasn't working. So that kind of started him working.
So that started the blueprint.
That started the blueprint. It was one tape.
Yeah.
He did like all those records, Ace of the Izzo, Never Change, Ain't No Love.
And this was you kind of instructing.
God, what a demo. Fuck.
Yeah, and this is you and kind of instructing Kanye to do these soul samples, right?
Yeah, he was already in motion by that point.
Okay.
So he kind of was just coming by, giving me beats as a manager. He wasn't giving me beats for Roc-A-Fella like that. Just he was giving around. Me beats as a manager because he probably needed money or something like that, more or less.
Mm-hmm.
He probably was like, that's probably why he made those beats specifically. Like, okay, these, one of the beat was somebody else's song. So he, as he playing the other ones for Jay, he was like, yeah, what about this one? They never changed. But he just knew it would work for Jay. So he had to get it from the other guys and work something out and all of that. But so it was really just a beat tape, and Jay did all those records, like 5 records in 3 days.
Wow.
So we got the tape on like a Friday, and by Monday, you know, Blueprint was like 6 songs in.
Wait, so that album wasn't even really planned to come out. It's just
it was
out of nowhere. He just started doing tracks, and then he was like, "All right, fuck it, let's do an album."
Yeah, so then he did those, and then go ahead. Which ones you said?
I said it was "Song Cry."
Nope.
Which one was it?
That's Just. It was.
I thought
H to the Izzo.
The joint where he just Mobb Deep and Nas.
It was Takeover.
Takeover, yeah.
It was Takeover, H to the Izzo. Because Takeover was really Beans' beat.
Okay, I didn't know that.
He gave it to Beans, but it was too late.
Mm-hmm.
And we couldn't clear the sample.
Beans was on Takeover?
Yeah, he's supposed to get that.
Oh, he's supposed to get the beat.
Kanye made that beat for Beans. I told him I needed a one beat for Beans. He was like, yo, I got something. He came and played it for me. And it was like a door sample. And I was like, there's no way mm-hmm. we can clear a door sample with the time we got left. Mm-hmm. You know, I need something without a sample. And we ended up putting another record on there. And then, so I had that record with the other beats that he was giving me, more or less as a manager.
You had Ain't No Love.
Ain't No Love, Never Change, and H to the Izzo.
H to the Izzo.
Right. So H to the Izzo was for Ghostface.
Really?
Ain't No Love was for DMX.
For DMX.
I remember that.
Yeah. And Never Change was somebody else's record. So those was all like, didn't have Jay on it, didn't have Jay intentions or nothing like that, because he didn't know Jay was working. So he was kind of like, hey, Jay's not working, I need to get some beats out.
Mm-hmm.
Let's spread these around. Let me try to get some Ghostface, I love Ghost. Let me try to get Cam. So it was trying to really get stuff to other people at that time, just as a producer, because everything was kind of Roc-A-Fella based. And it ended up backfiring. It ended up just turning out to be all Roc-A-Fella beats, you know. So, mm-hmm. And then from that point on, just did Girls, Girls, and Song Cry. after that. And then I'm like, yeah, you know. So I'm giving him a song, Cry, and he's like, yo, what I'm going to do with this? This is too slow. What type of song I'm going to write on this? And then it's like, okay, write, come up with the hook and I'll do it.
I can't see him coming down my eyes, so I got to make the song cry. I can't see him coming down my eyes, so I got to let the song cry.
And then,
you know. You came up with that hook.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep. I had to, I made it for Tupac.
I could see that.
Okay, yeah, it sounds like a Pac song.
Yeah,
Pac
would, I just kind of like.
Almost like, yeah, yeah. Keep your head up, dear mama, kind of shit, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because Jay had never really been vulnerable on a record like that, right?
Exactly. Yeah. And that's what I thought.
He was vulnerable on one other record.
On the volume one.
Soon, you understand?
Huh?
No, the mama.
You must love me.
You must love me. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. That joint where he was talking about his girl and shooting his brother. That was like, I remember hearing that shit. And I was like, this is a crazy record.
That was crazy. Yeah.
And he was just, and especially he was like, yeah, that was a deep one.
Yeah.
Pause.
Like that's like a record I picked from like the guy playing the record. Like Nasheen played the record, and I was like, yo, we need that. He ain't even do it yet. He was just like playing, I think it's like OJ's or some shit like that. And I was like,
Nasheen was the shit.
Yeah. Shit.
Nasheen has some fucking tracks. Shit.
He's one of my favorite producers ever.
Is that your favorite J record?
No.
What's your top five?
You know what? He subtly asked that, but we were talking for like half an hour
arguing on
like, what's hip hop's top five? We got to ask him. Like, and we were like planning our top five.
Yeah. That's hard.
It's because we were all arguing on which one should be in the top five, and we were all just
The thing is, you brought up Song Cry.
I think Song Cry is
that's
top five.
A top five J record, and then we
didn't agree with that. We don't agree with that.
We're from New York. We heard some. I was like, all right.
But the problem is, just like we were in New York when J was popping and every song was popping. Mm-hmm. So Song Cry was maybe top 20. You know, I would say top 20, you know, compared to some of the other tracks we would pick.
Top five for me, for sure.
Top five.
Yeah, I'm more towards those records, I think. Like Allure.
Life, I solemnly swear, change my approach, stop shaving coat, stay away from hoes, put down the toast, cause I be doing the most. Oh no.
Top five for me.
Really?
Ooh.
That's one of my favorite.
You know what?
That's one of my top
good
five
choice.
Records.
I used to, that was like one of my favorite songs off the Black Album, Allure.
Yeah. I loved Allure. I loved.
Wait. Why did you, I'm kind of curious about Allure. Because I felt like Jay didn't even like that record, but he felt obligated to record that record.
That was,
was this based on
like that record?
It was based on the documentary, right?
Hold on. You know what? Tell them why you hate this record.
Yeah, I don't. I'm not trying to be disrespectful, right? Mm-hmm. So I watched the Black Album, Fade to Black. I watched that a lot, right. And I analyzed it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm a big Pharrell Neptune fan. I love Pharrell.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? But when I saw him and he was selling, he was selling that song
right
in the documentary. Yeah. It's like, yo, remember in Carlito's Way when he's about to get away? This is that song. And he kept selling it. And Jay was like, yo, just put it on. And then he put it on and Jay's face was like, it's cool. And he's like, because I love you, Pharrell, and I see that you want to get this record on the album, I'm a record on this album. That's the energy I felt
right
on it. And it kind of, when I hear the record, I'm like, It sounds like a Pharrell track that he rushed just to get on the Black Album, and that was the energy I got.
But he was already on the Black Album
with
what song?
He did
Excuse Me, Miss.
Oh,
or Change Clothes.
I'm about to say that was Change Clothes. He did
Change Clothes.
Oh, Change Clothes. Or something? Oh yeah.
Yeah,
yes it was. Yeah.
So the reason why he was so adamant and aggressive and trying to be convincing was because Jay was only giving every producer one song.
Mm.
So he was trying to convince to him, like, yo, this just fits conceptually with the album.
So it needs to be the
exception. This is the closing.
Yeah, like this is the closing.
Yeah, yeah.
You're about to retire. This is that.
Yeah.
So he was trying to like sell him on the scene, and that's what he's great at. Like he's great at the fixing, like the picture, the whole, you know, what the song
is. Like a visionary.
The visionary. Right? Yeah, exactly. Because he was there when we was doing Big Pimpin'.
Oh, Pharrell?
Yeah, Pharrell was in the studio.
Oh, because of Timbaland.
Because of the Timbaland. And, you know, him and Jay had mutual friends and stuff. So Jay was, so they would hit me and be like, yo, could Pharrell come through? And stuff like, you know, and he'll come through more or less to like do hooks, to do anything, because mm-hmm. they just knew he was talented. So that was more of that. But by the time he got to Allure, they already had a rapport. So he was basically saying like, nah, one song, one song. And Jay wasn't there when he came and played it. So he already did his song. He was like, and then he did that one after, like mm-hmm. the next day. And he was like, nah, I got another one.
And Jay was but Crooked, I know what you're saying, though, because in that documentary, it was like he was hyping that song up.
Yeah.
He played the song, it's just like,
here's Guru's here.
But then the next scene goes to Timbaland playing fucking Dirt Off Your Shoulder, and Jay is like, yo, this is it right here.
Nah. Well, you know when the thing is like when Jay was with Timbaland and when Jay was with Kanye, mm-hmm. Jay made the ugly face. Yeah.
Just like, this is it. Woo!
The funky mm-hmm. warm sample one.
And he was just making those faces. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. And then when Pharrell was trying to sell him Allure,
he was like,
he was just like, you know, like he was probably maybe riding it in his head.
But that's the whole thing. It's like that's when you know it's a go.
When he's writing it in his head.
Because he go right into the song. You know what I'm saying? The other time it's like, oh, I like this. He's like, you know, but if he don't know what to do to it,
okay,
he would just move. You know what I'm saying? Like the other ones that he was excited about but didn't do.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like the NWA joint.
Yeah.
The funky worm. Yeah, the funky worm thing. Yeah, exactly. Like those joints is like obviously good beats, but it wasn't like, he already made a Dope Man song. He already did certain things mm-hmm. that he couldn't really double back on. But when you put a hook there, or you really give him kind of like a template, that's to me the best Jay to me. Like when the beat might say something, a la Hard Knock Life, or not, you know what I mean? Songs that other people might have had that had a structure mm-hmm. already, because he's not like a big hook person.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? Like that was never like his main thing. You know what I'm saying? It was kind of like, so anytime Nose is dead, that's why Pharrell Records was good with him, because he usually come with
it. It was like packaged.
Yep. Yeah, so, and what it's going to do and the type of flow, you know, you can use this type of rhyme. You know what I mean? So it was like that type of stuff. So those producers was good. That's why I think the first one, to me, the first real big J record to me was Money Ain't a Thing.
Jermaine Dupri.
With the Jermaine mm-hmm. Dupri record.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Because it just really had that, the hook, you know what I mean? It was kind of like, and it was something Jay said. But it was like him taking it, making it a hug, beat we knew already, you know, good feature, back and forth, good video.
So is that your second pick?
Nope.
No?
So you have Allure.
So you got Allure.
It's all random records, though. It's not going to be no
just get it. Yeah.
But explain why Allure, because it was packaged, because it sounded complete.
I love the storytelling on Allure. I love, like, you know, I think it's personal. Like the people he's talking about on it, you know what I'm saying? I know them, you know what I mean? Like, and the beat, I love the beat. You know, I just love the emotion of it. Like, just kind of like what Pharrell was talking about. Like, I think that Jay kind of nailed that
mm-hmm.
aspect of it to where it was that, like, you know, it's just the life, like the law of the game, you know what I'm saying? It's like, you know what I mean? The law of breaking the law. It's almost too much for me. You know what I mean? So it's like the way he explained it, I like when he talks about his life in that way. I like the song Regrets, the last song of Reasonable Doubt, Politics as Usual.
Mm-hmm.
You know, records where he like, you know, is soulful, but he's also kind of like explaining his past. You know, the things that mm-hmm. he's been through. Even like stuff, the records I didn't work on, I like a lot of those.
So did you appreciate a lot of the American Gangster songs?
That's what I was about to say.
Yeah.
I think that's mm-hmm. some of his top albums.
Yeah, so it was a couple really? Records on there. Yeah.
American Gangster is really slept on by a long shot.
I think it was so introspective the way he approached it lyrically.
I like the for real record on that too.
Blue Magic?
Nah, I know.
That's my favorite, probably. Oh, yeah. I know what you like.
Oh, I know.
Yeah, that one.
With Lenny Kravitz's daughter in the video, in the music video.
Yeah, I like that.
Yeah, I know he slept on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like that one.
That was a great record.
Mm-hmm.
So, wait, top five. Allure?
Yeah, Allure.
Politics.
Yes, sir.
Politics as usual.
Regrets.
Probably got to be like Only a Customer. You know that record?
Only a Customer?
I like that one too.
Over the Drake James joint?
Yeah.
Yeah. And let me see. Because it's like, I don't really listen to it as much.
What about one that you were in the studio and you're like, fuck?
Well, he's got one more. He's got to really pick that shit. That last one.
One more.
He's got to really pick that last one.
Why are you thinking that one? Look, mine was on my top five. I have You Don't Know, PSA, Song Cry, Just Want to Love You. I got to probably go with Girls, Girls, Girls.
Really?
Top five.
Original or remix?
The original.
Yeah. That's a good one. That was a good five.
So I think
I definitely love the
Cause you got
PSA like, is up there for sure.
For sure. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That definitely
that one
that was like crazy. Special at the time when it happened. Like, oh, what the hell? Just that one and the other one you said too. You Don't Know.
You Don't Know was disgusting.
You Don't Know just changed a bunch of shit when that dropped.
The way he's talking about, I could sell water to
him. That was like the nail in the coffin. Like, this is the king of New York.
So,
like,
what you think was better, that one or the remix with MOP?
The original, by a long shot.
Same.
The original. I mean, if the MOP, was good, we would have been playing the remix.
I like the intro to that one. I think it had a better intro.
Oh,
MOP one had like a longer intro to it.
Yeah, but that dun dun dun. That should just.
Oh, that's PSA. Yeah. Was gonna say, when you heard the new DJ Khaled Jay Z verse, did you really think it was top five of his verses?
No.
God did.
No, I didn't think so. It was good though,
but it wasn't.
I think it just like the context of when it came. I think, laid out next to everything that's out right now.
Right.
But I don't think if you laid those joints, laid it out with all of
his body,
other past, body
stuff
of work
like that. Yeah.
Of course, yeah, man.
You know what I mean? But no, it's up there though. I'm not gonna say because he. The length, of it paused, and then just the whole, he's constantly touching on those things that, he's doing the current Jay stuff where he's like addressing everything anybody just said about him. He's like getting all the, he know what people want, basically.
There's so many elements to that God did verse that I think are important.
Mm-hmm.
I think is that Jay never really talks about any issues that he has,
mm-hmm.
unless he puts it in his raps.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So like an air out moment.
So
basically,
he's telling you like what he's feeling and what he's annoyed with and what's troubling him,
mm-hmm.
and what's his problems.
Mm-hmm.
So it's great because you're like, oh shit, this is a Jay we never hear from because he's usually pretty.
Right.
Mm-hmm. He's pretty like to himself and corporate and private.
But he usually do that, I feel like, on those type of songs.
He does.
Like, when he got something like. Like, if somebody called him at the right time, they could get verses because he might just have stuff on his chest that he want to talk about.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And he know he probably won't make a record for a minute, and it's probably going to be irrelevant.
Right.
By the time he get to that record. So it's like, okay, what you got?
It's almost like a Dave Chappelle special because it's like
mm-hmm.
when you look forward to Dave Chappelle, it's going to be funny, but you know he's going to talk about some important shit.
Mm-hmm.
That no one ever really wants to touch on.
No, for sure.
And then, because Jay touched on a lot of shit.
Mm-hmm.
But what I think was great about that is that even like, it was like old Jay,
mm-hmm.
but new Jay.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So it's like the perfect combination of that old braggadocious Jay,
mm-hmm.
but it's like a new evolved Jay. And the most impressive thing about that verse is that with decades in the game, he's still able to deliver something
mm-hmm.
like that. And I think that's the biggest stamp, like.
Yeah, but I think that my theory behind the verse is that usually when the album starts, he usually do something called free play. And he usually just like go rap for a real long time, like in the booth. And it's like, and then he erases it. And sometimes it'd be like stuff from the album. Like one time he spit like a whole album worth of rhymes in one sitting. Like, and he just like, wasn't Blueprint, might have been around Blueprint 2 around that time, because that had a lot of features. So it was like different verses, different stuff, and he was just saying them all together. You know what I mean? Like stringing them together to remember them, because he don't write them. So sometimes he would have to like say them, to hear himself say them, to get the cadences and stuff like that. So I feel like if he not working like that, he gonna have a bunch of stuff, because it's just like piles up. You know what I'm saying? Like the rhymes is gonna pile up. So it's kind of like, hey, let me just dump all of this out right quick. So
it's almost like he was apple picking for like a couple months, and then he went in, and then he went in the studio and just unloaded the backpack.
Yeah,
and then he kind of sorted through everything at one run, and then figured out like, oh, okay, this is how I should organize these lyrics or these verses together.
I don't think he did it. I don't think he took it that deep. I think he just did it. Because he used to just do it like that. You know what I'm saying? Because it's all going to be relative to what he's talking about. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, and it's usually one or two takes. Yeah. Like, you know.
How'd you feel about the 444 album?
Oh, I liked that a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah, I liked it a lot. Okay. I didn't listen to it. Like I said, I heard a little bit of it when he was making it, but not like, you know, not enough. Just like a few songs here and there when I go by the sessions and stuff. But it was just always funny to me, because when I met Kanye, it was because No ID told me that he didn't have beats for Jay-Z. You should meet this other kid. And this was in 96. You know, at a, we was in a panel together for Rap Coalition, Wendy Day. She did a panel in Chicago, and I just turned into the A&R like a few days ago, and she was like, hey, I need an A&R. And she called Dame, and he sent me to Chicago. So I'm already a Common fan, and I'm like, dad, let me get with this No ID.
So you loved Resurrection?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Because that was a masterpiece.
Masterpiece, for sure.
For production, scratches.
Man, yep, fucking.
And No ID was insane on that.
It was cutting up just watermelon. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. They would just be cutting up like this, the most randomest stuff. You know what I mean? Like just the
yeah. Here's a little story that must be told.
I was thinking that in my head. I swear to God, that's what I was just about to say. It's a little story
that must be told. Yeah,
from beginning to end. You know what I'm saying? So it was like, yeah, like those rhymes and what he was doing made me want to go to Chicago. Like Outkast made me want to go to Atlanta. It was like, dang, I want to get those wings they talking about. But whatever, you know what I'm saying? Like, just like the way he painted that picture of it, it just felt like, dang, this place is like always 65 degrees and, you know what I'm saying? It kind of gloomy, but it's like good pizza and food and he was drinking beer and just kicking it. You know what I'm saying? It was like you heard that, like you could damn near smell the shit. So it was like, so I was excited, and I remember when he was like, yo, I got this kid that I'm working with that I think have more beats for Jay. And then I'm going to have him come by tomorrow. So the next day he came by, to the wherever they was building, had the conference at. And, you know, I met him, and, you know, it wasn't really nothing big. It was just like, hey, you know, I got some beats. I'm going to send them to you, you know, when I get back, you know, or I'm going to put some tape together and send it to you when you get back. And he was working with Derek Angeletti probably at the time.
Oh, really?
I have to ask you, was this before he did the tracks for Mace Harlem World?
Yeah, this before. I remember when he did those.
Oh, shit.
Like, I remember when he was doing everything at that point, because we were still talking. He was still sending me stuff as well. Mm-hmm. And he was trying to get on Jay, trying to get on Beans. He ended up getting on Beans, did the truth.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that eventually, and that's the first record I did on my own, like, okay, cool. I could pick all the beats and stuff like that. I had a good relationship with Rockwaller because of the Do It Again record and stuff. So I went to him early He did a few on that record. Yay. Just did the Who the Fuck Want What record. They both had one on there. Just had one. Kanye had one. So that was kind of like the beginning of it. So I had to prove it with him because Jay wasn't, you know, I didn't want that conflict. So it was like Kanye was already good. Like Jay heard a beat that Kanye did for Mad Rapper with Raekwon, The Ghetto, I think it was called. And Jay just kept listening to it. And we was driving, and I was like, oh, you know, that's my producer. He was like, for real? He got more beats like this? I was like, yeah, that's his, that's what he do. You know what I mean? He was like, oh, give me some of those. And, you know, I gave him a couple, and it didn't work, and then hit. He wasn't, nothing wasn't hitting him.
Was the Scarface one the first one?
Yeah.
Guess Who's Back?
No.
No?
Can't be life.
This can't be life. This can't be love. This can't be right. It's gotta be more. This can't be us.
Oh, forgot about that.
Yeah, this can't be life.
That's on the that's compilation album, one. Right?
Yeah.
With him and Beans. And no, it was on the Dynasty.
Dynasty. I'm sorry, yeah.
Yeah.
Which that's was the one with the Dr. Dre drums.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah, because that's what it was. It was kind of like he just, we had a conversation about different producers, and he made a beat out of the conversation. Like we spoke about Dre and Explosive and them drums. We spoke about Puffy using that sample. Like I seen Puffy, I heard a record that Puffy played that had the Harold Melvin and Blue Note sample.
Mm-hmm.
It was a Missing You version. Cause I was there when he did Missing You.
Damn.
Like I seen Puffy make Missing You. You know, I was with Sauce Money. And he was writing.
And he wrote that.
Yeah, so I was with him every day in the studio when he wrote all the songs for Puffy. He asked me to come to the studio with him. Like, I would, it was only him and Jay. So, you know, I had a lot of time on my hands. So he's like, yo, come to the studio with me. And we didn't know what he was going to write, you know. So Puffy comes in, he plays the Missing You record. I'm like, damn, you know, it's done, you know. And then he play another record. Then he's like, damn. Then he's like, yeah, I don't want to use these. I want to use this. Doom, doom, boom, boom, boom. he plays the Sting record. So me and Sauce like, oh, he's going for it. Like, he's really going for it. You know what I'm saying? Because we already thought the other one was good. You know what I'm saying? So I explained that to Kanye, that he passed on this one and went for that one. So Kanye goes, find that sample, and put it with the Dre drums.
Oh shit! Okay,
which the explosive drums, right?
Yeah,
yeah.
And then he played it for me. He was like, "What about this?" I was like, "Jay is gonna take that. Send that to me." He had to send it in the mail. You know what I mean? So it took a couple of days. Played it for Jay. No, actually, I remember sending him money, or like our FedEx thing, so he could next day it. Because I remember like, "Yo, send that next day." You know what I mean? And like really. Sending him like a slip or, you know, something. It was something like that I had to send him so he can next day it. And soon as Jay took it, like, just like I thought. Because it was just like, you know, it was definitely didn't sound nothing like the Puffy record. I couldn't even remember how the Puffy record sound. Because I wasn't even telling him to use it. I was just telling him, like,
the sample.
Yeah, like, that's, you know, more about Puffy process of, you know what I mean? And we was going through RZA and everybody and stuff. So it's kind of like, when I look at him, it's more like RZA and Dre to me. It's like, he want, you know, he's not trying to be as dirty as RZA and not as clean as Dre. So it's like
right in between.
Yeah. So it's right in between where it's going to have some structure. It's going to be a good song, but it might be a dirty beat.
I never thought of that. But you're right.
It might be some trashy drums. It might be some, you know what I mean, something that's going to keep it in, you know, at that time.
Yeah, yeah. You know, it's either like a dirty-ass sample with clean-ass drums and production that binds it together, or it's the opposite, where the sample is super clean and then the drums are super dirty.
Yeah, like Gold Digger.
Mm-hmm.
It's something like that.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? It's, to me, the best example of that, where it's like, you know, the drums is its own thing. It's not, like I said earlier, it's not trying to mesh. It's like they just gonna coexist.
They can coexist.
Yeah, it's like this drums is hard and this sample is crazy. But, you know, it ain't like technically.
Like you said, they could both live on their own if they needed to, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yep. Yeah. And that's kind of how that was his thing for a little bit. for a little while.
You still, like, every time Kanye drops an album or mm-hmm. he does a release,
mm-hmm.
you know, I've noticed that you're always in the city. Like, does he still trust you to, like, review and listen to shit or to check out what he's doing sometimes? Or?
Not really. He like to have people there sometimes. So with Jay, like when we did Black Album, I was with him every day. You know what I mean? Whether he was going to, that's why I was in, you know what I mean? Watching, you know, in the Fade to Black. It was like whether we was flying to Rick mm-hmm. House or Miami to Timberland. We flew to Virginia a couple times to go work with Pharrell, even before those records. Like one time I flew on a private jet to Virginia with Sadat X.
Oh, yeah.
To do a song with Pharrell for Jay-Z. He said he wanted for Sadat X on the hook. And
well, you know that Sadat X was on our podcast, right?
He was one of our first guests.
And he told the story.
Oh, for real?
Yeah.
That's crazy.
And he said, I don't know, he's like, man, they had like lobster and steak on a private plane. And I'm, he's like, he's out living it up.
Yeah, me and him was smoking. We smoked like the Trent, because we lived on the same block. Like he lived in Harlem.
Mm-hmm.
He lived on 120th. I lived on 119th.
I got a good story about Sadat X.
So he, uptown. What you call it? So I remember being like, Jay being like, yeah, I'm going to get Sadat to come to VA with us, and I want to get him on these hooks. I think his voice would be dope, on a Pharrell beat, whatever. So I'm like, yeah, he live right around the block for me and stuff. So they sent the car for both of us. Like, this is the car for me. Then I went to pick him up. Then we went to the jet. So we thinking, so I was like, nah, we going to Jersey. He's like, we flying to Newark? I was like, nah, it's like Teterboro. It's like a private shit, like we get on the jet, you know what I'm saying? So it was like that type of thing. And I remember us getting there, and they was like, oh yeah, y'all can ride in that van. And we was like, all right, bet. And I was like, yeah, we can smoke. He was like, for real? So he was like, damn, I would have bought more weed. So he was all mad, because, you know, we thinking we getting on a real plane and stuff. So we like, so we got there. He did a record, he did a hook, you know what I mean? I don't know, we never used it or nothing, but probably stayed in Virginia at that point. But yeah, so that was like, so I would be with him more often, and G would be with Kanye, because he would do more like, you know, the admin shit, making shit happen, just whatever is needed in that regard. So that's why we kind of like got into that point where I'm working with more newer stuff. I had to keep doing it. I couldn't.
Is that why we didn't really see you in the documentary? Cause I was curious about that.
Which one?
The
Genius.
One, yeah, Genius with Netflix.
Yeah,
with him at that time, like day to day kind of thing.
Yeah, yep. Yeah, I was just like when I was in the office that day, it had to been like a deadline or something like that. Like it was something really a lot going on. That's why I mm-hmm. think it was so nobody was paying attention. You know what I'm saying? Because it was like.
You're talking about when Ye was like going into everyone's office and, yes. and playing All Falls Down.
Yeah, exactly.
For them. Mm-hmm. And then they just acted like they didn't care.
Yeah.
But motherfuckers was busy.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
But was Ye kind of like, I wouldn't say tone deaf, but was he just unaware of like shit that was going on? And he would just kind of like, he would do that where he would just like play the record and mm-hmm. then, because the narrative was that it looked like he was playing the record and everyone was ignoring him.
Yeah. No one saw the greatness.
Or they just didn't hear the record and say, like, that's not good. Like, we're just going to keep working. But then there was the flip side of people saying that, who was Kanye to come in while these people are working to just go and play their records?
Right.
So I was kind of wondering, what was the actual narrative? Like, was he kind of overstepping boundaries and just kind of...
He was playing records for people that... It really didn't even matter. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
It was just more like, I'm going to go to the office and just, you know what I mean, just play the records with people, where everybody that probably matter was mainly at the studio in the regards. You know what I'm saying? So if like Dame and everybody, we already signed them, so everybody was already on board. But with him, it was more about like the urgency of it. Like, when is people going to look at me like I look at myself?
Mm-hmm.
So it took time for that to happen. And a lot of it was just more because of just the artist. Like, if we, you know, like I said, if albums took two months to come out, and we got a deadline for, let's say, Beans, who's coming out in October, and we got to turn some stuff in, because we was always in that mold at that time because of how many artists we had by the time he was coming out. So he definitely was low in the totem pole because it was kind of looked at more as a production deal with me that he signed to, that they thought would probably be a compilation album, kind of like in more that than it was an artist album. But by the time he was there playing them songs, we already moved past that. We already got to the point where he was looked at more as an artist,
mm-hmm.
and he was coming to the office more. But then there'd be people in the office who kind of like more got blinders based on what they're working on at the time. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, they can't think three projects ahead. You know what I'm saying? And that's where he probably was at the time. Like, because, you know, because it was like 01, and he didn't come out until like 03. You know what I'm saying? So, he came out like 04, right?
Yeah, 04.
It was January
04. Yeah, 04. Yeah. So, you know, so it took time for that to happen in that regard. So, the stuff he was kind of looking for, it just didn't happen that way. You know what I'm saying? It just had to come into play, unless you went to flex like camera. Like, you had to go outside and create something for people inside to really pay attention. Or just wait your turn. You know what I'm saying? That's the only way you could really skip. Mm-hmm. You know, skip the line. If you like, if he would have just took all fours down to flex.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Then everybody at the label the next day would have been had a press conference, but had a fucking, you know, a conference. You know what I mean? We've been in the conference room trying to figure out how to, you know, get behind the ball. You know what I mean? How to catch up on it. Yeah. So it was more, you know, just him going around to people. And that's just how people was. They wasn't really excited by much at the time. It wasn't like it was.
It was just busy.
Yeah, it was, like, yeah, it was another record to them at that point, basically. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
When you say your management company, right, the hip hop since 1978.
Yep.
You were managing Just Blaze, Kanye, which obviously we're seeing the production side of how you were managing them.
Right.
How were you guys involved with, like, the artist side for, like, Jeezy, T.I., Lil Wayne, Nicki Minaj, Drake, and, like, Griselda now, right?
Yeah, I do Griselda separately with another partner, my partner Chase Infinite. It started as a production company because at first I was like, okay, I don't want a conflict. But then it's like, okay, we need a team. We need some producers.
Yeah.
I tried to do it with Dane, with Buckwild and Digga and Alchemist around that time. But Dame didn't really want to take money from them. And that was weird to them. They're like, what you mean you don't want to take no money? You don't want to manage? He was like, nah, I just want your beats first. I just want all the beats first. So he just wanted the first right refusal type of thing. So they was wanted other beats, other places. They was thinking like, hey, I want to be a producer. So that kind of, you know, I wasn't big enough to do it on my own at that time. Like, I needed him to do it. So when G came, he was like, yo, we should manage producers. I was like, I kind of tried that, but, you know, it didn't work out with Dame. He was like, no, don't worry, I'm going to do it. And you just set up the meetings, and I would be with the producers. I would deal with the producers outside of The Rock, and you deal with them here. Because me dealing with them there was a natural thing. It was just me being an A&R. But me dealing with them outside of that become a conflict, like, why you ain't take that beat, or why did you sell that beat? Why did you, you know, all of those type of things. So by the time we did Justin Ye, the artist thing happened because Ye turned into be an artist. Mm-hmm. So that put us on a different radar. So Wayne thing happened by... That's a weird story. It happened, you know, Larry Johnson, the football player.
Yep, Kansas City Chiefs.
Kansas City Chief.
Yep.
Remember, he like won the, he was like the
Was he signed to Roc-A-Fella management, right?
Yeah, he signed to Roc-A-Fella management. But what happened is that he reached out to me in his rookie year and asked me to help him manage Lil Wayne.
Wow.
Larry Johnson, he was managing Lil Wayne.
Wow. Are you serious?
The football player?
Yes, football player. He called me and said he didn't,
before Cortez?
Yeah, Cortez was like his role manager, one of his best friends, kind of like his DJ at the time. Mm. So Larry Johnson hit me first and was like, yo, I need your help, you know. And then he hit me again and was like, yo, I can't do it. You know what I mean? I'm just going to chill out. I got to focus on football.
Wow.
He took off. When he hit me, it was his rookie year when he was managing Wayne. Because he was like, yo, this is Larry Johnson, not the football basketball player. I'm like, I know who you is, nigga, you do. Yeah. All-time leading rusher in college football history.
Yeah.
At the time, because he had the record.
Yes.
So I was like, you like the all-time leading record? He's like, oh, you know, oh, I know you watch football, da, da, da. So I'm like, yeah. He's like, yeah, I need your help with Lil Wayne. I was like, Lil Wayne from New Orleans? Cash Money? What you doing with him? So one thing lead to another. It was another girl representing him, and Melissa. So she was working with Larry Johnson. So when Larry Johnson left, she was by herself doing it. And then she reached back out to me to help him. And then, you know, I would help her. But then he was kind of leaving Cash Money, meeting with Jay, meeting with people. And during that time, Atlantic wanted to sign him. And I was working there. And they basically reached out to the girl and said, hey, you know, we want to do the deal with Wayne. And she basically told them, like, yo, you got to speak to hip-hop. And I was working there. And I wasn't allowed to manage anybody as well.
You were, like, the senior VP of A&R for Urban Music, right?
Something like that.
Yeah,
Atlantic. Yep.
Atlantic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, me and G, Cole, whatever. Mike Heron hired us. Shout out to him. So we ended up, you know, going there. Because, like I said, the whole conflict with, not the conflict with Rock, but just reached the limit creatively. I feel like all the artists was in the same lane. So I went to Atlantic. It was like Trick Daddy, Twista, Little Kim. Mm-hmm. I felt I could grow a little more, beat selection, work with other people. You know what I mean? Do R&B, get a bigger check, obviously. Because mm-hmm. That was one of the main things, too. Because they wanted to hire G. And they wanted to give us a deal, a label deal. So they took a meeting. Mm-hmm. And they was about to give him more money than me. So I'm like, shit, why you ain't asked me to go? You know what I'm saying? They was like, oh, no, we thought you was like Roc-A-Fella. You can't never leave, you know? So they just thought that. And I was like, not necessarily, you know what I mean?
Wow.
So they was like, okay, cool. We'll give you the same deal. And y'all can come over together if y'all want to. We would love to have that. So I kind of basically threw my name in the hat, like, fuck it, you know, because it was like literally quadrupling the salary.
Wow.
Gosh.
Yeah. Like, I never made six figures at Roc-A-Fella. I don't even, when I left, I was making like $60,000.
Really? What?
Yeah.
Well, Jay's going to get a piece of my fucking...
Yep, I was making like 60. I think I just got a raise to 60.
Oh shit.
After, wow.
This is after Black Album and The Blueprint?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
What the fuck?
Yeah, I started out.
Wait, did you get royalties on those albums though?
No. Only what I wrote. So it was easy. You know what I mean? It was an easy call for me, where it was like they coming in, they was like, I think I might have like 250. Wow. They was like, yo, you want to get 250 or something like that, and advance for the label, and a this, and a that, and a corporate card, and a, you ain't got to come to the office. G going to be at the office, and da-da-da. And
it's a weird situation, because that's when you're working 7 days a week, like you said.
Exactly, yep.
Taking naps in the studio, mm-hmm. keeping the machine going for four or five years.
Yep, and they was kind of always, and also they was... going in different directions.
Yeah, that's when they were separate.
They were separating. Mm-hmm. They was kind of breaking up.
Right.
So it was like, I told Dane, he was like, go get your money. I told Jay, he was like, wait a little bit. I told my brother, he was kind of mad, you know what I mean?
That you were leaving?
Yeah, not like, you know, he wasn't like upset.
He was like, hurt, right?
Yeah, he was like, you sure, for real? You know what I mean? I was like, yeah, I got to offer this much, this, that. You know, eventually, I was still living with him at the time for a little bit. So it wasn't like, it didn't create no friction or nothing like that. You know what I mean? But it was kind of like, one was cool with it, one was like indifferent, and the other one was like, hold on. So I'm like, I don't want to be in the middle of this. I'm out of here. You know what I mean? So, and then Def Jam came to me like, yo, you should, Jay's going to do his own thing. You should come over here.
That's why Jay was telling you to hold on?
Yeah, that's because they came to me later. Right. And was like, hey, he's going to do his own thing and stuff. And I was like, oh, I definitely don't want to do that.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
He was like, going to become president, right?
Yeah. It was like, you know what I mean? So I left, which was funny. Wow,
that's such a
it's kind of a slippery slope.
It's a lot of drama.
Yeah.
You know?
And it was funny because, you know, it was like Lior and Julie and everybody trying to, you know, telling me to stay. And I'm like, nah, I'm gonna go to Atlantic. It's, you know, it's a fresh start over there.
Craig, yeah.
You know, Craig Coleman is cool. I like, you know, like him and stuff. And when I was starting, we just signed like T.I. It was like the same day. Like, they're like, you know T.I.? I was like, yeah, I know T.I. Because him and Bean's first record was together. You know, KP was his A&R. That was my friend. He said he signed a new artist from Bankhead. I signed a new artist from South Philly. And they did a song, Two Glock Nines, on the Shaft soundtrack. The new Shaft when it came out with the
Samuel Jackson.
Yeah, it was on that.
So, was Trap Music the first album on Atlantic for him? It was like 2004, right? Around there?
He had that Neptune's production.
Which I think that one.
That was the first one.
That one kind of flopped, right? But I don't know if that was on Atlantic.
I think that wasn't Atlantic. That wasn't Atlantic. Yeah. The first one we did was.
With 24s?
Yes.
Ooh.
Yeah. David Banner produced.
Rubber Band Man,
yep.
Yeah, that one.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Were you part of the people that told him he has to change his name to Tip? I mean, from Tip to.
I think that was the first album.
Nah.
He was on the same label as
Tip. Yeah. Yeah, he was on the same label, Arista. Oh, okay. They was all on Arista.
Arista, that's right.
Yeah. Because KP was on LaFace, and he got a deal through, KP was the A&R for LaFace. You know, he DJ now, KP the Great and stuff, you know what I mean? So he, you know, he was like Outkast, worked with them and Goody Mob and everything. So he got his own label, Ghetto Vision, and he signed Young Bloods.
Yeah.
Mm.
And then the next artist was T.I. And he had the soundtrack for Shaft.
Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of like what he was doing at the time and stuff. So he, so I knew him from KP already. Like I already snuck T.I. into the Jay-Z, Jermaine Dupri weekend in Atlanta. Can I Live weekend. They had like 96, like when anything came out. Like T.I. was, you know, KP was with him. I was like, okay, I'm going to ride with y'all because I know they ain't going to leave me out here and I'm going to make sure we all get in. So it was like nobody knew what T.I. was. It was just like Tip. I knew him. We did a song. You know what I mean? We kicked it a couple times. So when he was coming to Atlantic, he was like, man, y'all coming over here? All right, bet, man, we going to have to do this shit, man. You know what I mean? Because it was like, you know, we was already cool at that point. So it was like Tip. The next time it was Lupe. I knew him already from Jay. He was probably going to sign with us at a time almost. You know what I mean? I thought.
Really? Ask him?
Did you have a...
Yeah, he used to come to Baseline.
Were you educated with him and Kanye like getting together, or did he already know Kanye from Chicago?
Yeah, that was just like, that was a Chicago thing. Okay. But he was around us way before that though.
Yeah.
Not even Jay. Like he was with Jay and stuff. Like Jay knew him. Jay liked him a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And stuff. So he used to come through Baseline and stuff and play music. And when Jay gave away clothes, he would be there with us. Because Jay gave away clothes every season and everybody go to his house and just be a bunch of Air Force Ones, War Ones.
Are you serious?
I swear to God.
I thought you were saying like a bunch of Roc-A-Fella gear.
Nah, it's just like he'd just be.
Just Jay clothes.
Just Jay clothes. Then. Like yeah.
Throwbacks. Or
yeah, whatever. Just stuff that. You got to make room in his closet.
A bunch of button ups.
Probably before the buttons up.
Before the button ups.
Yeah, it was a time of button up era.
The North Carolina jersey.
Wait, so every so often Jay would just clean out his closet and get rid of the clothes, and then everyone would just come through and pick what they wanted.
Yep.
That's pretty sick. It's kinda, yeah. I can't lie, that's pretty sick.
You walk out of there with bags. You like, you walk out of there a bag of sneakers and a bag of clothes. At least, you know, like a laundry bag.
Damn.
That's pretty sick.
Shit, yep.
That's pretty crazy. I would never think that shit.
I still got stuff from there.
For real?
Yep. Like some snow pants, some snow windbreakers that he had that they made him wear, like he was like a, just for a photo shoot type thing, just because they was baggy. How about
that? You must have some ill like Roc-A-Fella shit, huh? Like any Letterman jackets, like one and shit of like ones. That?
Now my mom's do. My mom do. She just showed me some stuff.
She was oh just shit! Me. She That's at the crib.
She got the varsity, the original Rock varsity, with my name on it.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
That's dope. That's dope.
Yeah,
it was funny that when we drove back from Vegas, I dropped him off. Legit, one time like driving from a street, I'm leaving. He's like, "Look what Jay-Z sent me," and he sends me a picture. And the picture says, "Thank you for all you did, hip hop." And it's a big ass Roc-A-Fella chain.
Nah, it says you're the best that did it.
Oh yeah, you okay? And it was this big, like just gold crusted fucking chain. I'm like. Damn, son. Like, he goes, look what was left. It was just sitting outside. I'm like,
yeah, it was sitting outside my door. I was like, holy shit.
Like, you don't understand. Like, it should look like at least 25,000 easily, bro.
Damn.
Wait, so is that the first Roc-A-Fella chain you got?
Mm-mm. I never wore gold before a chain or anything like that.
I was going to ask you to bring it, actually.
I gave it. The first one I gave to my nephew. Big son, and the second one I gave to my son because I know he was always mad that I gave that one away, but he wasn't born.
So why
did he wasn't born when I had it? So he was like,
he's like, I was supposed to get that, right?
So I knew once I got the next one, I was like, oh, okay, I know where this is gonna go,
right?
Mm-hmm.
And then you got that new one,
yeah, that's when I gave him.
Oh, that's the one you gave,
yeah.
So you've gotten two Roc-A-Fella chains,
yeah, yeah,
and you just never kept them, you just gave them away, huh?
I never even put them on my neck.
Really?
Mm-mm.
You didn't even put them on to just see how it would look?
Nah. I never even bought a chain for it because they gave me the piece.
Oh, they gave you the piece.
Yeah, they gave me the medallions and stuff. So when I got the medallion, I remember when Dame gave it to me. I was asleep. He woke me up at baseline. He was like, here you go, huh? Like, here's your piece, your rock, whatever. And I was like, I go, you know, I think I went back to sleep. Yeah. And then I gave it like, I think I just gave it like literally right to him. I don't even know if he asked me for it or what happened. I don't know how I even gave it to him. I just asked him if he wanted. I just.
Can you explain that a little bit? Like why, you know, a lot of people would see that as a defining moment. You know,
I mean, that's what Kanye was striving for,
and they would like, dude, they would actually treasure that a lot, and it would, you know, they would put a lot of weight on it.
Mm-hmm.
But it's funny, it's like, from what I'm hearing, it's like you helped build Roc-A-Fella, but you are the most un-Roc-A-Fella person, kind of, because you.
That's true. That's definitely a fact. It's basically like I never used to wear Roc-A-Wear. Dame used to be mad at me. Because it was like, I didn't think I needed to show that I was Roc-A-Fella. You know what I mean? And it was like the opposite. I was almost trying to hide that I worked at Roc-A-Fella.
Why is that?
Because it was, you know, it was a lot came with it. You know what I mean? Just as far as everybody knew but it was early. So as it was happening, like let's say the first couple years, it's like, oh, you work with Jay. It ain't no big thing. You know what I'm saying? It's just like, because Jay's not that big yet. Mm-hmm. So it kind of happened gradually as people, you know what I mean? So they didn't really get a chance to like be excited or swarm or anything. You know, it kind of just was like, before they know it, it was like, oh shit, Kanye's your artist? Oh shit, wow, you work here now? You know, I was just so engulfed in it. By the time people figured it out, or by the time he got big. So it wasn't like, you know, it was just a normal thing. Like I was at a Jay show, and like he was opening up for Little Sean.
Damn.
You know what I mean? And there was like 30 people there.
Little Daddy Sean?
Wait, No. Little Sean. Hickey's on my neck.
Hickey's on my neck.
Remember that song? I Made Love for the Very First Time.
Yeah, Little Sean. I made love for the very first time. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that record was fire.
Yeah, that song was dope.
He goes by
put Hickey's on your check like Little Sean.
Yeah.
Get a pissy junk for Dom Perignon.
He had a good flow.
Dom Perignon.
Yeah. Because he ended up using the Biggie line when Biggie shouted him out.
Yep.
All I want to do is make you feel all right. That's
what Pac was going to do a song with when he got shot in Quad.
Yeah.
He was going to do a song with Little Sean.
Wow.
Yeah. So it was always funny.
He's on Instagram now. He goes by Behind the Smoke.
Yeah. That's my boy.
Yeah. Oh, yeah?
Always. Yep. He was always real cool with Roc-A-Fella.
Oh, yeah?
I'm like, him, Akinelli, and a couple other guys was like, we even managed them.
Oh, basically. Shit.
We was managing them. We managed Ock. We managed Sean for a little bit. Then Cam. That's how Cam thing happened.
Because
we started managing them first.
Because
he kind of came back around. Because him and Dane fell out. Not Dane. They fell out, you know what I mean? Like over some, I think he left them at a show or something like that. Like, like they didn't know how to get back. And they got lost from like Connecticut or something like that. And you know what I mean? And then it was always the Big L thing. Because you had Big L was like bigger than everybody, technically,
because
he was first.
Yeah.
But still didn't really get anywhere yet. You know what I'm saying? But still like people knew Big L before
they knew him in the streets.
Yeah, exactly. You know what I mean? And this is like weird because Big L was like right before everything that became popular, like the mixtapes. He was never on mixtapes like that. He was never on like R&B remixes, like everything where he would eventually kill, you know what I'm saying? And, and probably got a, you know, had a bigger status from that. But, you know, he kind of was one of the first to really voluntarily go underground. You know, sign the Fat Beats and be like, oh, shoot, I'm going to make my own shit. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Making records and stuff. And that's when we started working with him again.
Was he going to sign the Roc-A-Fella before he got killed?
For sure.
Mm-hmm.
I was in the studio. I was working with him. He was signed to Roc-A-Fella in a group with McGruff.
Oh, wow.
McGruff.
Because we couldn't sign him solo because he did a deal with Fat Beats for an album. So we had intentions to maybe do something after that album.
That was like Ebonics when he dropped that?
Yeah. I don't think it ever came out because I think that's the one that eventually came out after the fact, the big picture, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
But he was never signed solo there. And even the Fat Beats one, we was going to do more with them or maybe even do it with them.
Mm-hmm.
So that was like a talk because he, you know, started really working with Dame, started really, you know, fucking with us, which was like crazy because we always had a weird digging in the crates relationship. Fat Joe.
Oh, that's right.
Jay.
It was like a little beef.
Right.
Yeah.
Jay and Fat Joe at the time.
Yeah. Showbiz
mm-hmm.
and our other friend. Like, you know what I mean? Like, that's what it was. Like a male boyfriend, a male friend. And showbiz, a male friend was showbiz girlfriend, and a male boyfriend was our friend, basically. So it was like they got into something, you know. So we done had like multiple things with them, but I was cool with Buck Wild. We was cool with Big L. We was cool, you know what I mean? But, you know, Fat Joe, I remember Fat Joe came to the office one time, and they had like literally a sit down, like a straight up, felt like, you know what I'm saying? Like many times him and Jay had to like really, you know, have sit downs, you know what I'm saying, about shit, you know what I'm saying? Because they just thought shit was happening, you know what I mean? But we always knew most mutual friends and shit like that. But yeah, so at that time we was trying to do the Big L thing, but it was, you know what I mean, eventually, you know, the tragedy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, rest in peace.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. You've just always been focused on the work, right?
Yeah. Because it was a privilege to me, you know what I mean? And an opportunity that I couldn't even explain where they come from or how you even get into it. You know what I'm saying? So when I got into it and I had the opportunity, it was like, okay, I really gotta can't take this for granted.
Yeah.
So it was really that. And then Jay ended up getting me to pick the beats with the A&R stuff. I think I don't even know. I thought I was telling that story. I don't know what happened. But I was telling that story about how I became one. But that's what happened was that with Biggie, we did Brooklyn Finest. I took care of the session. Biggie got there early. I asked Jay, could I come? He was like, all right, bet. Biggie got there before Jay, and I was there before anybody.
Wow.
So I called Jay. I'm like, yo, Biggie's here. What you want me to do? I have to just make sure he's straight. So I called him, bought him some food, put him in the studio. He's good. They in there smoking blunts and shit. Then Jay and them come, and they have the first session for Brooklyn Finest where none of them do anything. They just sit there, you know, pass each other the pad. They say, I don't write. And then they play the beat at least 100 times, smoked 100 blunts, and everybody was there. Like, everybody that was close, you know what I'm saying, that was like a friend away was there. It was like at least 20 people in a small D&D studio room. So after that, Jay asked me what I want to do. I told him I want to make beats. He said, go to Ski House.
Oh, man. Ski's one of my favorite producers, man.
Yep. He said, go to Ski House. Tell him I told you. Tell him I told you to come there. And tell him, you know, what you want to do. So I started going to Ski House every day. He lived in Brooklyn off Lafayette, right down the street from Jay. Literally across the street from the Barclays, like right there. So I would go to his house every day. Camp Lowe would be there. You know, working on records and stuff. I'm, you know, just there. A couple guys would come through. Ken Sport, he'll come through with records. People come through. So we've got the sample for Streets Is Watching. I found the record. I mean, I ain't find that it was sitting right there. You know, Ken Sport bought it over, I guess, or something. And, you know, we playing the record. And I'm like, damn, this is crazy. Ski like, oh, yeah, whatever. So I called Jay on the phone and played a record for him.
If I shoot you, I'm brainless. But if you shoot me, then you famous. What's a nigga to do when the streets is watching? Blocks keep clocking, waiting for you to break. Make your first mistake.
On the phone.
On the phone. He's like, what the fuck is that? I'm like, yo, it's just record, it's beat. I found that Ski House. He's like, I'm coming over there right now.
Wow.
He walks to Ski House from his house. Right up the block, Lafayette. He was right on State Street, you know what I mean? Straight shot, four blocks probably. So I tell Ski, yo, Jay's coming through. For where? What'd he come for? Yo, he wanted to hear that beat. What beat? This record, the one I've been trying to tell you to make, whatever. So he was like, oh shit, I gotta make the record. I gotta hook it up.
So you played him the sample.
I played him the sample. That's why it's the beginning of the record, because that's what I played him. So Ski's doing something else.
Did you get producer credit?
Nah, of course not.
Fuck. Oh my God.
So Ski's doing something else. He hooked it up, chopped it up, did his thing, played it for JJ. Like, what is this? It's not the record hip hop played for me. Where's the record hip hop played for me? He's like, he just played the record. Well, just make the record. So he went back, did it kind of like it was, you know, add a little strings to it, chopped it up, add some drums, and we did the record. And after that, he said, you're going to pick all my beats. And then I became an A&R after that.
God damn.
So, that's crazy.
You know what I mean?
That's crazy.
Yeah.
Okay, I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
Why did Ski, JC stop working with Ski?
Because Ski started Roc-A-Block.
So that wasn't part of Roc-A-Fella. That was totally different.
Nope. He had got his own deal.
Was that when Sporty Thieves was on there?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. He had Sporty Pigeon. Thieves and a couple other people that he had signed with him. And he just kind of got more busy with that in Camp Low.
Mm-hmm.
He started doing that. Dame kind of stopped managing Ski. So I think they might have fell out, but he didn't really because he did Who You With. He did other records.
The second album, but after that, they just stopped working together.
Yeah, because at first it was like a Clark Kent, who got a studio, I come to your house, let's make a record. Mm-hmm. Go to Clark House, make a record. Go to Ski House, make a record.
Yeah.
You know, or sometimes Chubby House would make a ski record or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And that was more all he was with. Like, that was all Reasonable Doubt. It was mainly Ski, Clark Kent, Peter Panic, who was Clark's producer. He was with Clark. He did Regret. And then you got Premier,
mm-hmm.
who did the three records for, you know, for some cash. You know what I mean? For straight cash, whatever. And then Deshaun C.
I went to high school with Sean C as well.
Oh, were?
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Mm-hmm.
So he was already he was an X-Men?
The funny thing is, he was an X-Men, but I didn't know it until after high school, after we graduated.
See, and I started seeing him, shit.
I'm just like,
he was on that Boogie Blonde.
Exactly.
Shit.
I'm like, oh, shit. That's fucking Sean.
But that's how Boogie Blonde, too. That's what was funny, because he knew all of them. Mm-hmm. He knew Sean C.
Yeah.
He knew them. I was like, so you know the X-Men? He's like, yeah, Roc-A-Fella live in my building. That's how I figured it out. Because mm-hmm. it was like, you know, because I remember Ross Swift was dope.
Yep.
And we was like, oh shit, who's this? You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, oh yeah, I met him before. And it would just be like that type of stuff, like real casual.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? At that time, I ain't know nobody. You know what I'm saying? I was like excited to meet anybody.
Yeah.
At, you know what I mean? Back in those days. But he, you know, already knew a lot of those DJs and stuff. And Jay went through a nice amount of DJs, like a few X-Men was his DJ, Eclipse DJ for Jay.
Eclipse, yeah.
At a time, Dr. Butcher was a DJ for a minute.
Mm-hmm.
That was my favorite, one of my favorite people, just period. He taught me a lot just being around him. Real cool dude. Because he was like Ock DJ.
Akinelli.
Yeah. Ock always had a good DJ. He had Rob Swift. He had Dr. Butcher. He was like, he was around Jay a lot. He used to come out in Jay shows and do, because he had bigger records. During that time when Jay had that much records, I could come out and do Put It In Your Mouth and
Free. Yeah, that's right.
You know what I mean? And Jay could just chill for a little while. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And come back on and do his records and stuff. But that was like a little break in the show, I guess, because that's what Kane used to do for Jay.
Mm-hmm.
So it was like, he always did that. He always brought somebody out to rap. Eventually it was Beans, you know. But he had other kids too. He had a kid named Hosta Ripper. I used to come out from Jersey, and he'll perform at every Jay show. He was like, but he could do anything. Like, he was like one of those, like, real, like, he wrote for a lot of people.
Oh, yeah.
His wife, Latifah, and, like, you know, he was from Jersey, but he had, like, this ill, I don't know, he was just like a hell of a performer. Like, he could just, like, rap and be saying stuff and be doing it at the same time. And, you know what I mean? He was just, like, a real witty to where, like, you know, back then, you know, you had to get the crowd on your side.
Yeah.
So he was, like, one of those guys. You could just put him on stage and walk away, and the crowd would be making noise. And, like...
So why he never popped off? Or what?
The songs. You know what I mean? It's kind of like a pre-battle rapper type thing.
Like a Supernatural.
Yeah. It was like that, like, you know what I mean? Like a rapper that was just a good performer, a good freestyle.
But couldn't translate it to records.
Yeah, couldn't translate it into records and stuff. So that was like, kind of like his problem, you know. But he found something as an artist. You know what song he wrote? He wrote, You Must Have Forgot.
Roy Jones.
Oh, shit. Really?
Because I remember he was in the video. I was like, anytime he in the video, I'm like, I know he wrote that. He had to be the ghostwriter.
Oh, man. Oh, that's hilarious.
Yeah, because he got signed to him for a minute. You know what I'm saying? You know, them type of guys would sign you and have you write their rhymes
this day,
and stuff.
Every boxer from Florida still uses that song. Every boxer from Florida still uses that song to this day.
Yeah,
must have forgot. I'm positive. Like, what was the group? It was a group with Roy Jones. It was
He was in it.
Of course, D would know that song.
Yeah.
Yo, Body Headbangers.
Yeah. How you know that? The Body Headbangers.
That's a big song in the boxing world.
Because you have that in your computer.
Yeah. Yo, so many
boxers. The only motherfucker I know that has that in the computer.
So many boxers use that song to train. Like, they love that song, man.
Really?
It's like a really hype, get you like riled up type of a song. It's hilarious.
Oh my God. God. Yo, hip hop, why do you know these things, though?
I'm fucking us everything, man.
Oh, shit. It's crazy.
They don't call me hip hop for nothing, man.
I know.
That's hilarious, though. Nah. That he, what you call it. That you got that record in your Serato. You ain't got no Roy Jones in your Serato?
Stupid. Oh, man.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Hey, hip hop, we're nearing like 3 hours.
For real?
So, yeah, yeah.
So that's crazy. Oh, shit.
We gotta.
I'm looking outside. That shit is definitely dark. Yeah, yeah. Like,
I went from day to night.
That's crazy. Yeah, that shit is definitely.
We gotta. We should wrap this up.
Wrap it.
Yeah, yeah.
Yep.
Oh, what do you call it?
We gotta do a part two soon, though.
I definitely want to smoke up. I want to smoke with
you don't want
to
do
the part two. We might have to just smoke up and then talk. Yeah.
Bro, no, he's in that. A different category of smoking weed. You better be careful.
I mean, yeah.
Nah, it's not for play.
Well, I won't smoke. I'll let him smoke and I'll get the contact.
Yeah, they get
Hey, yo, hip hop. Thank you so much for coming through, man.
For sure.
Man, thank you,
let's
brother.
Give hip hop a round of applause. Shit.
The best.
If you want to watch more episodes from R.O.A.D Podcast, click either links on the left or the right. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube page and get updated on new uploads throughout the week. Peace.